join us on the Path Radio Mix online. And to get there, type in thepathradio.com. That's thepathradio.com. And enjoy free streaming music all day long. That's it. thepathradio.com. All right, now let's get to the main show, the monthly social podcast with me, your host, Guido Perino, as you go on with Guido. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the monthly social. It is June, and I'm ready for the June bugs. I hope you are, too, as summer is here. On our show this month, we've got actor and artist from British Columbia, Josh Bogert. We're going to talk with author, inspirational speaker, Lynn Ray, as we cover bipolar disorder, depression, mental health, and her story on how she was able to overcome it. And then we're going to catch up with John Cusimano of the Fastest Land Animal Band. Yes, that is the same John Cusimano that is married to Rachael Ray. And we're going to talk a little bit about that, too. All right, let's get going. Now, before we get going, a quick word from one of our friends of the podcast, Johnny Prosciutto. Johnny Prosciutto, artisanal Italian homemade products. We make it like our grandfather, or as we say, nonno. Naturally cured, old-fashioned, and delicious. Order online at johnnyprosciutto.com. And we deliver right to your front door, where the only thing left for you to do is enjoy it with your friends and family. That's johnnyprosciutto.com. Our friend Anthony Johnny Prosciutto will take care of you if you put in an order for your sausage. And it's good sausage to barbecue in the summer. It's good all year round. But what a great product he's got there. So check him out at johnnyprosciutto.com. And speaking of barbecuing, it was barbecue season is in full effect. And I started barbecuing. And after about 16 years now, it was time to move on from our Broil King barbecue. I had repaired it a couple of times, served really well, really good barbecue. I know it's got some great warranties as well, but I was going to have to invest a few hundred dollars in trying to replace some parts, and I'd already done that once. So we said, all right, you know what? 16 years, not bad, not bad. So, but we went with something different. I wanted to try a Napoleon barbecue. So it's got the stainless steel cooking grates, and it also has a side burner, a searing side burner. And I've tried that a couple of times, and boy, just what a difference. Do I ever love that? It's really cool. So, but you know what? It may serve different purposes for different people, the style of barbecues, and there's a lot of choice out there of what you can get. So if you're looking for a barbecue, check it out. Check out the Napoleon. In the few weeks that I've been using it, I have been really very much enjoying it, even more so than my faithful Broil King that I had for a long time there. So we are in June and we got a few things to go through. I'm pretty excited. The podcast has now reached 54 countries worldwide. So it's been streamed or downloaded or listened to in 54 countries. Now, when I started this 4 years ago, I would have never imagined that people across 54 different countries would be interested in, you know, my stories and the interviews. And of course, the show has evolved quite a bit since those early days. And I'm so very much appreciative of all the guests that we've had on the show. And listen, if you're listening right now and you're not a regular subscriber, please, by all means, subscribe. It's free. You get notified. It's across all these different platforms. If you haven't taken the time, subscribe. I don't charge anything for this. I don't even make anything on this. It's a hobby, and I've been enjoying it. And it's just purely out of passion and enjoyment. And some great messages that we've had from folks here on the show. And speaking about the guests, so I've got a couple of affiliate shows, as you know. So on YouTube, we recently launched the Path Radio Mix video channel. And our latest episode on there is Desi Rex. Desi Rex from the DeMalls 777 band, previously Chicago Malls. But what a great interview. It's a two-part interview. Right now, as I'm doing this work, part one is out. Part two should be out in a couple of weeks. Depending on when you hear this podcast, it may have already come out. But check that out. And then we also have the monthly social channel now on YouTube as well. So as you're listening to this audio and our guests, in a few weeks, they'll be converted and there also will be a video version available. So if you go to youtube.com/@themonthlysocial, you'll find a whole bunch of videos. And last month we had Ryan Jones from Corvus Lore here. And so his video just came out on the monthly social on YouTube. So a couple of great sites there for you to consume the video content of the audio. And in the case of the Path Radio, it's an exclusive. There's also the Coach's Call if you're more into sports. We've had a couple of good shows there, really focusing on the NHL playoffs a lot. I'll start to get into some other topics for sports as those come to conclusion. But, you know, one of the common themes that I've encountered, if you will, the last little while interviewing people is this. It's this message, and it's an important message, I think. We're going into summer. We should do this all the time, but we're going into summer, and maybe we all just need to recalibrate a little bit. And here's the message. The message is, be kind. You're going to hear several guests say it on this show. You're going to hear several guests say it on the Path Radio show. Just be kind. You know, and when I'm out there and I'm watching people drive around and you know, cutting people off and just doing some stuff that we don't need to do, just be kind. Everybody's going to get to where they're going to get to. And let's just do it and everybody can get there alive and safe and you know, be courteous out there and be kind to each other. I love what the guests are saying as part of their message for that. And I just wanted to reiterate that and say, yes, let's do it together. Let's be kind as we embrace summer. And speaking of embracing, let's embrace our next guest. Kicking things off here for our June show on the monthly social from Vancouver, from British Columbia, artist Josh Bogert. Let's hear from Josh. Joining us from the West Coast, out in Vancouver, British Columbia, rising electro pop music singer-songwriter, multi-instrument artist, and producer, Josh Bogert. Josh, welcome to the show. How are you doing out in Vancouver?
I'm doing great. Thank you. How about you?
I'm good. It's warming up here. I'm in Ontario, so I'm warming up here. Nice, nice.
Okay. Yeah, no, here it's crazy. It was like 10 degrees last week, and then this weekend it's supposed to be like 35.
Oh, wow.
It's ridiculous. It's like the weather is all over the place here. Like the craziest we've ever had, I think, because it's never been like that, you know, up and down, because it'll probably get cold again after that.
So like, really, it's going to get cold again?
Yeah, because they said it's going to be like 2 weeks of summer and then we're going to be back to like, you know, rain. Oh,
well, we had like 3 weeks ago, I was outside and it was like short weather. Mm-hmm. Like it was 25 degrees, 26 degrees, hot and sunny. And then it started to rain and it rained for 15 days.
Yeah. So. It's crazy. So, I mean, yeah, I'm excited. I'm going to be in Toronto in June and July. So I'm hoping it's going to be good weather, but in my experience, yeah, June and July there is like hot. So
you're coming up, you're going to do the Canadian Music Week, right?
Yep. Canadian Music Week and North by Northeast.
What's North by Northeast?
It's like South by Southwest, but in Toronto.
Yeah, I know what it is, but
it's like a festival for like, I guess, up and coming artists, which I think is awesome. It's very cool. Basically, I'm gonna play a bunch of shows, but I've heard kind of the showcase is a free ticket to all the events and stuff. So it'll partly be, yeah, I'll play a show or two. But I'll also be like able to go to all of these events and network, which is super helpful as well.
Yeah. It is the show of shows. Like there's lots of action happening. And I think during the pandemic there, we didn't quite have that. So.
No. Yeah. Well, yeah, totally. When you can't hold events with that many people, it gets hard to like, you know, get in the room with people.
Yeah, for sure. So, well, Toronto is looking forward to having you as here as well. So,
thank you.
Yeah. Hey, so listen, I want to get to some of your music in a bit,
And I usually do this towards the end of interviews, but I thought with you, I flipped the script a little bit and I would do it at the beginning. Just a couple of little rapid questions. So it'll be like, sure. I'm going to give you multiple choice. Like, I'll give you two choices. You pick one or the other of what I give you.
Okay.
So it's like the, you know, the one word type of thing. We'll call it, I always call it something different. Maybe, I don't know. I don't know if it sounds right. Joshing with Josh. I don't know. What do you think?
Joshing with Josh. I like it.
Yeah. All right. Let's try. Okay. So okay. Here I go. Ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Justin Bieber or Metallica?
I'm a big JB fan. We got to go with Justin Bieber. Yeah.
He's going with Justin Bieber. All right. Fender guitar or Gretsch?
Fender.
Fender. All right. Yeah. Piano or guitar?
Guitar. I just play it way more.
Really? See, I was thinking you were going to say piano on that one. Okay. Timbits or donuts?
Donuts. If I'm going to have a donut, I'm going to have the whole thing.
Really? I'm wrong. I'm going two wrong and wrong. I figured you were going to, if you went Bieber, you'd go Timbits because he did the whole Tim Biebs thing.
Oh, that's true. But I tried the Tim Biebs and I was not impressed, actually.
No way. I
didn't love those flavors. No. Also, I don't know. With Tim Hortons, it's like their donuts used to be so fresh. And it's like, they're still good, but I don't know. They used to be better.
Okay, I got to ask you. Did you guys have out there, they were called Long Johns?
Yeah.
You had them, right?
Yeah, we did. 100%.
You still have them?
I don't know. I haven't been in a long time, actually.
I can't find any. Like, it's been, like, down here in Southern Ontario, I can't find the things. But they were, like, my favorite. They're the long, for people who don't know what they are, they're like a long donut with the chocolate on top.
Yeah, it's like a rectangle.
Yeah. Right?
Kind of like a rounded rectangle, but yeah. it's like a long, it's like the sub sandwich of donuts.
I'm getting hungry. Okay. Snapchat or Instagram?
Instagram. I deleted Snapchat like, I don't know, 8 years ago or something. When Instagram introduced that's probably exaggeration, but when Instagram introduced like the video or photo chat, and yeah. Like all the Snapchat features, I just deleted. It's not Snapchat. I was like,
Snapchat is gone. Out the door. Strawberry, vanilla, or chocolate ice cream?
Chocolate.
Chocolate ice cream.
Yeah.
I'm vanilla. I'm
okay. Yeah. Vanilla would be my second option. Strawberry's last. Sorry, strawberry.
Sorry, strawberry. Okay. Last one. Vancouver Canucks or the Toronto Maple Leafs?
Oh. I'm going to say Vancouver Canucks because I'm from Vancouver.
Yeah.
But they're a crap team. Let's be real.
Well, I mean, the Leafs are, you know, not doing that great. But
no, the Canucks are not doing great either, though. As far as I'm aware, I don't watch a lot of sports. So I'm not the most educated person to ask about hockey. But I hear the Canucks are not great.
But you're going hometown. You're going hometown. You're picking.
I'm going hometown. I have to, right? That's cool. Loyalty. Loyalty is important, you know?
All right, man. Look, just a little bit of fun there. Just a little bit of fun.
I like it.
Loosen things up and yep. Go with the one-liners. Maybe they'll work their way into our chat as we go along here, Josh.
There we go.
Look, let's get into the music. How did you or when did you get started into music? And like, where does the Josh Bogert music journey begin?
It began really early. Like I could say it started when I was four. My parents put me in violin lessons. But I would say even before that, like I was still in the womb and my mom and my older brother were going to like mom and taught music. So I was like, you know, pre-birth exposed to music classes. And it was just always in my house too. Like we would be listening to music all the time and my brother and I would sing along and jam out and air guitar and all that stuff. And and yeah, I played like classical violin for 7 years as a kid and wow. Just loved like figuring out, you know, songs from Star Wars and Mario and like all that stuff. I would just try and figure out how to play them. And I really wanted to play guitar because I thought it was really cool. And I started guitar when I was like 10 and I quit violin the next year. I was like, this guitar is so much cooler than violin. Cause you can play almost any genre on it. So I started playing guitar really seriously and saxophone in high school and also singing too. And around that time started writing songs and then, yeah, I was like 12 years old. I decided like, this is what I'm doing. I'm 100% being an artist and that's what I want my career to be. And it never changed. Like I never questioned it from that point on. It's always been like, you know, that's my goal. And I started working towards it like at that point.
So I see some guitars behind you there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Have you, growing up, did you have like a guitar? Like, were there musical instruments all over your house? Like, did your parents put them all over the place for you guys? Or
I think kind of, because what started it was like my grandfather played the violin, and my parents had one of his violins, and my brother was obsessed with like seeing it, and that's, they started him in lessons, and then I kind of just went because he was doing it too. And then as we kind of got into music more, like we had like these kind of toy instruments, like guitars and stuff. But someone told my parents that, that I shouldn't start playing, cause I wanted to play guitar right away. And my parents were like, you have to wait till you're 10. Cause someone told them, because of the size of the fretboard and the way it is, it's like, you kind of have to wait because of the size of the instrument until you're a bit older. Whereas violin make like really small ones. So that's what I did. But I remembered, I was like, when I turned 10, I was like, you said I could play guitar when I turn 10. So I'm playing guitar now.
So you have pictures of guitars all over your wall waiting to turn 10. I'm trying to wrap my head around. You were 4 years old when you started playing the violin.
Yeah. They start you out with a cereal box with a ruler taped onto it.
Wow.
Yeah. Just because, like, you know, instruments are expensive and they can be fragile. And when you're 4 years old, it's like, you don't understand that. So they start you off with a cardboard box with a ruler taped to it so you can learn how to hold it properly. And so that you're not going to, like, basically, wow, you know, you just learn how to respect the instrument, I guess, before you actually get to
I picked up a violin a couple of years ago for the first time.
Yeah.
And it sounded like I was killing somebody. Oh, like, it just,
absolutely.
I have no violin talent whatsoever. Like, none. I can play some guitar, but I can't, like, the violin, it just never, I didn't know.
Yeah. Cause with guitar, like, you put your finger on the space between the frets and it makes a nice sound. Right. Whereas with the violin, it's like, you have to, if your finger is not in the right spot and your bow is not at the exact right speed and pressure, it sounds like garbage. Yeah. And like, I haven't played it in quite a few years. So if I try and pick it up, it doesn't sound good.
I was going to say, you said sax, like you had a little bit of, you know, the Simpson, the saxophone going on there from the Simpsons too, I guess. I'm joking around. But do you work some of the other instruments into your music these days, or?
Yeah. Like, I quite honestly, a lot of it is like, I think more so the theory based. So like, violin gave me classical theory, right? And saxophone gave me jazz theory. So a lot of that comes into play when I'm producing music. Like, to be honest with you, the only thing I'm recording live is guitars and vocals. Like, nothing else gets recorded. It's all programmed in my computer or sampled or whatever it might be. Just because that's the sound, right? It's like, if I recorded it just wouldn't sound like a pop song. I could. But I just don't, because like, it's not a sound I'm going for, right? Even the pianos, like, I could figure out a piano part and play it, whatever, that's fine. But I generally just program them because it's faster.
Makes sense.
And then I learned how to play it later, like the song a couple songs ago, it was like a very piano heavy song, and I programmed the whole part when I recorded it, and then for the music video they're like, yeah, we want you to play it. I'm like, great. I gotta learn it now. And I didn't realize how hard I made it on myself, and so I had to learn this like part where my fingers are just like stretched out like the maximum.
But you did it.
I did it. I was actually surprised that the part that I programmed was actually physically playable, because I was worried. I was like, oh, I don't know.
I gotta write that down. Physically playable.
Yeah, because you can program. You can put like 16 notes on there. But if you're just programming MIDI, and it's like, well, you don't have 16 fingers to play 16 notes.
Listen. So you mentioned. Grandpa, and you mentioned parents, and is that your inspiration to play music, or do you have multiple inspirations to play, or
the main thing is, like, I mean, that's obviously kind of what kicked it off, was influence from my parents and you know, my dad's dad, who played all these instruments. He played violin and guitar and sang a bit, I think. Most of it is just, it was such a big part of my life growing up that it's become a part of how I interact with the world and how I understand the world and how I like communicate. if that makes sense, right? It's like, it was part of my, like an integral part of how I learned to communicate was through music. And it was just a part of everything. Like when we got in the car, we would play the radio. When we were at home, you know, we would put CDs in and listen to songs. And like, that was just, that's just what we did. And like a very big part of how I identified and how I communicated. And I became known as like the music kid as well. So just like, I don't, it's just ingrained in my personality, I guess, is my inspiration to do music.
I was going to originally say to you, you know, like it, you're passionate about it, right? It's built in you. It seems like it's part of your DNA. I was originally going to say, did you feel some pressure because you had the family background in the music, and did you feel pressure that hey, I got to do music? But it doesn't sound like that way, like to me at all. It just seems like you, you know, it was like putting on your shirt sort of thing, you know, like,
it's, yeah. Like the original idea that, you know, my mom always says to me, the original idea was that she just wanted us to have that to go to maybe later in life. Like, if, you know, you need something outlet, like you can play music for as a hobby, as a hobby, but there was no pressure. Like we tried everything. Like I was in soccer, I was in baseball, I was in hockey, I was in everything. And that music is just what I gravitated towards. I would be like, you know, on the soccer field, sitting down, like picking the grass. Cause I was like, I was a competitive kid. I just didn't care. But when it came to music, it was like, that was what I got excited about. Right. Not necessarily playing like, you know, Bach on my violin that the violin teacher told me to play. I didn't want to do that. So there were some tears in terms of practicing, but especially at 6 years old, it's like, no, I want to play what I want to play. But
I'm trying to picture you running on the soccer field and singing at the same time, Josh. Look, before you started to pursue your music career on a more full-time basis, you spent some time on TV. You were on the Family Channel, the Disney Channel. You did a series called Backstage. It was a show that focused on a performing arts high school. It had over 60 episodes that were aired, and you played a character called Miles on the show. Yeah. Are there any parallels between you and your Miles character?
I would say absolutely. Purely based on like that show was like my fourth audition as an actor. I'd never taken any acting classes. I was music growing up, right? So I was not, I don't think I was cast as an actor. I was cast because I was very close to the character that they were looking for, you know, just as myself. And I think, you know, they were looking specifically for someone who could play like 5-6 different instruments. So that was my tape. Like when I auditioned for the show, it was like, I've played, you know, 15 seconds of guitar, 15 seconds of saxophones, 15 seconds of drums, 15 seconds of piano, et cetera. And then I also just had the personality that they were looking for that character. It was just kind of who I was. So yeah, I would say there's a lot of similarities. I think Miles made some pretty poor decisions, so I don't identify with that. but no, other than that, I think there's a lot of similarities for sure.
Did your friends start calling you Miles when you were doing that, or?
I think like a couple people would do it like jokingly.
Yeah.
I mean, on set too, it's like everyone calls you by your character name because they don't know your real name, especially the first few days. They're like, they just say the character name because they've all been reading the script and they have no idea who they cast. Like they don't know the names of the actors. They just know the character name. So they call you by your character all the time. So I got used to it.
How did you get involved with the show? Like, you obviously auditioned, but was there a tip? Was there
I basically, my singing teacher had like a student that were a woman who had been her student previously, became an agent, an acting agent. And, she was looking for clients and I was like, yeah, sure, I'll give it a try. And it kind of just like happened right away. Which I didn't expect. I thought I would maybe book a commercial or two, you know, where I had to like sing or something, but that was really how it happened. And then it, you know, kind of launched a whole series of events, obviously, but no, it was pretty like out of the blue.
Do you still keep in touch with any of the cast? Or let me ask this, would you ever consider taking on another TV or movie role down the road? Does it have to have a music component to it? Or
no, definitely not. Like, after I was on the show, I became serious about acting as well and started training and started, you know, practicing that craft as well. I took a bit of a break from it over the last, well, mainly over the pandemic. I just, like, yeah. You know, I was writing my album, recording my album, and I was like, I just want to focus on that for now. And then a couple months ago, I started talking to agencies again. So I now have an agent and am auditioning, like, for,
oh, wow.
You know, I'll have like two, three auditions a week. So it's like, it's definitely, I would absolutely consider doing another role. Yeah. Cause I'm constantly auditioning for them, but yeah, I took a bit of a break from it.
That's okay. Folks, you hear it. Josh Bogert is available. So let's get him back on TV where we want to see him too. 100%. So
yeah, it's the weirdest like industry though, because like it's the only place where you do like a million job interviews and like book 1% of them. You know what I mean? It's like you just gotta constantly do it. And it's usually like the stupidest things. It's like they don't cast you because you got the wrong eye color or like height or, you know, you're just like, they need the very specific person. And like, it's very unlikely that as good as an actor you are, there's certain things you just can't change. Right.
Does that bug you at all? Like, you know, you're like, man, like I really went into that and I was in it and my wrong eye color. Yeah.
Yeah. No, sometimes. And I mean, you never know too why they didn't cast you, but it's like, sometimes I'm like, oh, this is the perfect role for me. And then you don't hear, right. It's also like one of the industries where they just don't tell you unless you get it. So like you kind of have to do the audition and forget about it, which I've gotten good at, but it's hard for sure. Especially like when you really love a role, then you start thinking about it. You're like a week later, you're like, I wonder if they've seen the tape. I wonder what they think. I wonder if I'm going to get a call back. So you got to kind of let it go and just be like, you know what happens? It happens. And that's it.
You know, it's kind of interesting. So like on the flip side, you have music and music is more instantly gratifying, right? Because you create something, you see it, you feel it, you share it, you get instant feedback, whether it's at home or with your, you know, your immediate circle of folks you test things out with or an agent, or you put it now, you know, you put it online nowadays, right? Yeah. You instantly get that feedback. The totally. Acting, it's kind of like you pour everything into it and then you're kind of sitting there waiting and you're going, well, was I bad? Was I good? Do you like totally. It? Do I like it? You're just kind of waiting, right?
Yeah, no, 100%. It's definitely, they're very different industries, because on the one hand, yeah, like the music, it's like you have full control, because basically being the artist in music is not like being the actor in film and TV. It's like being the executive producer or like scriptwriter. Or you in music, you're actually doing a lot of the different roles that would be individualized in film and TV because the industry is so much larger. On the flip side though, like actors are much better represented in terms of like when you do book a job, the union takes care of like a lot of the, you know, making sure that you get paid adequately and making sure, whereas like with music, it's artists get taken advantage of way more than actors, I would say.
Different. It's a grind. It's a different grind. We know that,
yeah,
right?
100%. Yeah.
Look, so you're a young artist here in Canada. You've got over 300 live performances under your belt. You've gone coast to coast.
Mm-hmm.
I have a feeling about this, but, and you've alluded to a little bit about it, but what defines Josh Bogert as a musician now?
Yeah. I mean, I've struggled with this question. I guess my answer is I wish I had like a definite answer to that question, because if I did, I think I would be a lot further than I am right now. But I think that's the thing that a lot of artists, you know, have to figure out. It's like, what defines me as an artist? And I think I'm figuring it out. I want to say stuff, you know what I mean? That's very vague, but I want to like, I don't ever, when I'm writing a song, I don't want it to be like surface level. I always want there to be meaning behind it. Pretty much every song I write is truthful. Like it comes from some aspect of something I've actually experienced. And even the details, like the specific places and the specific, things that I reference in my songs are actual things that are accurate to my life. And that's, I guess I just want people to like be able to get something from that and experience life through music the same way that I have. If I can help someone understand their situation through a song, then I feel like I'm giving back, because that's how I understood so many situations in my life growing up, if that makes sense. I understood it through songs. I went, oh, that captures the feeling that I have. I understand myself better now for having heard that in music. And so that's what I want to provide, I guess.
Yeah, you want to, it sounds like, you know, I'm hearing, I want to be an authentic artist. I want to share lived experiences and influence people's lives so that, you know, it's not just an empty message, but something that I can, like, that they can take away, right? 100%. Like something meaningful where, you know, in a bunch of years, you look back and you go, yeah, man, I enjoyed Josh's music and this is what it helped me do, or this is how I related to it, or I attach it to this event in my life, right? Because that's, you know.
Yeah, the biggest fulfillment I get is when, like, I have a song out and someone sends me a DM or comments on my post saying, like, hey, this, you know, thing happened in my life, whether it's, like, you know, sometimes it's something really tough and hard that happened in their life. And they say, like, you know, your song helped me get through this or helped me process that. And like, that to me is if I can do that for one person, then that's like, I've done, you know, everything that I can hope to do with music. I think, that's the ultimate kind of fulfillment for me and the reason why I do it. And, also like with the songs too, I find it so interesting how like one song can mean different things to different people. Like I have a song called Dreams that I wrote when I was in a long distance relationship, and I started playing it for people, and like some people would say, is this about like someone who's passed away? Or other people would say, is this about a breakup? Because it can be taken in so many ways, because that feeling of loss is universal. Like everyone's felt that in some way. The exact details are, you know, up to that person to kind of interpret. But yeah, I think that's the music.
That's pretty deep, right? And like we're talking about a genre of pop electric type of music, right? Is there always a message? Like I think of some pop songs, and I just sometimes you go there and they are a little bit empty, Josh, right? Yeah. But you're not trying to take them down that path.
No.
Is it challenging to fit that message in a pop genre?
I think it's not super common. Well, I don't want to say not common, because there are definitely pop songs that I listen to that are, you know, have that kind of deep message in them. Yeah. But I think a lot of times they also don't. And that's part of, I think, where I come from both sides of music in a way. It's like I started writing songs at a young age. I come from the perspective of a lyricist and a songwriter. But I also, you know, I was exposed to a lot of electronic dance music because my brother was a DJ, or still is a DJ. And he was really into like house and dubstep and like really hard electronic genres. So on that side of things, like learning to produce music at that, because those songs, like it's so hard to produce those genres. So the technical production skills required to do that, paired with the soft skills of writing, I think that's kind of where my music comes from. It's like kind of, I want to blend both. I find in electronic music, the lyrics just get forgotten. It's like basically just an instrument that's there. The vocals are not really important. It's just something to be there to like sound like a human. And then on the other end of the spectrum, singer-songwriter music, phenomenal stories. And then they record it like kind of not great. And they don't spend time polishing, you know, the production of it. So that's where I feel like I love to just come at it from both sides. And like, if I can really create a great song first and then also polish it to the point of like being electronic pop song that has that punch, has that clarity, to me, that's like the ultimate, I guess, you know, expression of what I find most important in music. So yeah,
a lot of attention to detail, Josh.
Yes, very much so.
I get the sense, and that's great. Like, you know what I mean? Like you have your direction on that, and I think you got something unique going on with those two styles and your attention to detail. Do you compare yourself to any other musicians?
Yeah, absolutely. All the time. I mean, it definitely, it's something that we're told not to do too much. Cause it's like, you know, if I'm always like, oh, but this person did this, and especially like people that are more so my peers, it's like, yeah, you get into the compare game where you're like, that person got this many streams on their song. Why didn't mine get that many streams? But no, I'm always looking up to obviously like bigger artists as well. And I get a lot of like writing inspiration from like JP Sachs. I think he's an incredible lyricist. Production wise, like John Bellion has been a huge inspiration for me as well. and yeah, I mean that the Bieber album, from 2015, Purpose, changed my perspective. That's when I started really producing music too. It's produced by Skrillex, that album.
Right.
It just changed my world.
in what way? Like, was like inspiration or
before that? I was recording music, but it was all recorded. Like, I would record drums with mics. I would record everything. And I didn't have any sense of any electronic production. I didn't understand it at all. And then I heard that album, was like, I need to figure this out. So that's where electronic production really started for me.
It's interesting, you know, like I, and as I talk to artists, the different triggers or the things that you pick up on or some event, you know, that makes you go to that next step. So you've talked about, you know, mixing and mastering and producing and doing that. You're doing that for other artists as well?
Yeah.
And you do it through your studio. I think it's called Postcube. Is that
Postcube?
Right?
Yeah, that's Postcube. Right.
Now, are you splitting time between that and your own music or now focusing still more on your own music?
I think like recently it's been like a bit more focus on this album just because, like it takes up a lot of time to release an album. And that's kind of where my focus has been more so, for the last little bit. I think come like, again, being in Toronto as well for June and July, I'll be very focused on playing live, you know, promoting this music. I think in like August, especially September, October, like the fall, of 2023, I'll probably, bring it back to like getting into more writing sessions, obviously for myself and others. And then, definitely trying to produce more and just, you know, do some stuff for some other folks. Cause, I'll have some time to really, you know, dedicate that to that side of things.
Is it hard to produce other artists while you're focusing on your stuff? Like, do you find a bit of a blend or?
I think besides the time, not really. Like, I find it refreshing actually when I do have the opportunity to, like, if I'm working on my stuff, sometimes I'll have another project for someone else and it's very different, obviously, from my sound. And it can be super helpful because I'll start thinking differently about their song, obviously. And then I'll go, oh, wait a minute. What if I make this change in, you know, the stuff that I'm working on? It's like, I think it's super helpful because especially because I get to work in other genres that aren't necessarily directly tied to mine, but like music is music and those things can really help bring a unique flavor if you borrow techniques and strategies from other genres. So I would say it's definitely helpful.
The collaboration helps between that. 100%. Now you've played across, I said earlier, you know what, you've played coast to coast, you've played in places like Toronto, the Bud Stage, Scotiabank Center in Halifax, Commonwealth Stadium in Edmonton, Canadian Tire Center in Ottawa. Love that. The really good center. Too bad it's in the middle of nowhere, but really good center.
I know, yeah.
You've been at several other venues. You have a favorite stop along the way?
Oh, favorite one.
We're not offending any city here. It's just, you know, fucking venues. So
I'm just trying to think of what the favorite stop would have been. Probably, I mean, the Budweiser stage was just like, that was one of the big ones on that tour. I just remember it so vividly because it was like the most people I'd played for at the time. Yeah. Cause I think it was like 5K or something like that in the stadium or in the amphitheater. And the rest of the venues we played on that tour were like 1,000 to 2,000. So I was like super stoked. I was like, that's so many people. And then now like the most I've played is the Commonwealth Stadium. Cause that was halftime show for the CFL. Right. So there were like 40,000 people there. Now, I don't know if all of them were paying attention at that point. but I had a good group of people like just that came down into like the front. So it was kind of this weird. I think that's probably my favorite because it was a great mix of like, yeah, I'm playing for 40,000 people in a stadium. But yeah. It was also at the same time a very intimate performance with like 50 people like right there by the stage.
Yeah.
So it was like both at once. I had this little intimate concert and then I had this massive crowd as well that was kind of paying attention. Some of them were off getting snacks and stuff, I'm sure, using the
bathroom. No way, man. No, there was no snack. They
wouldn't miss the real entertainment. Football. But no, I think I would say that's my favorite just because it's like it's such a unique experience.
Yeah, and I mean in Canada, like that's a milestone. Like that's an iconic thing, right?
I didn't spend near as much money on floating platforms though as Rihanna did, I'm sure.
would you have needed to be tethered to them really? I mean, I don't know. Who knows, right?
Yeah, I know. I take the risk. Risk it for the show.
Miles would have taken a risk.
He would have.
I think we just lost power here.
Oh wow. Yeah, you're all of a sudden.
Yeah, I'm on a backup battery, Josh. I think we lost power. I don't know how long this will last. All right, let's just keep going. So I was going to say to you, in your performances, you've shared the stage with other notable acts like Daya, the Vamps, Sabrina Carpenter, who's currently on the top 40 charts with her hit Nonsense. Mm-hmm. You've also performed, we just talked about the CFL halftime show. Mm-hmm. Any fun stage stories from those experiences?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, like performing with those acts, it was pretty cool. And like, you know, they were all super chill and nice. And, you know, it's kind of cool to be able to get an inside look at like, you know, how those performers do their shows and how they prepare beforehand and all that stuff. But I think the craziest stories are like the kind of things that happen on stage when tech goes bad. Cause you know, in these arenas, you got all wireless systems and things like that. And, you know, batteries die and all this stuff. I remember I was performing a duet with one of the other girls from my TV show that I was on. And she was singing at the time and I was playing guitar cause it was her verse. And I guess the battery pack in my wireless died. And I noticed cause it went out in my ears. Like I couldn't hear it. And I'm like, okay, well it's died. So, I was playing, I lift the guitar up cause I'm not singing at the time. I just boost it up to the mic and play like this so that it's coming through my vocal mic. So that the engineer can still have a signal to go. And then some tech dude comes running out onto the stage while I'm playing, swaps my pack. And then runs off. And then like 10 seconds later, the guitar comes back through and we keep going. So it's like mid song, just like quick battery swap. The show doesn't stop, man.
Wild. And did anybody notice? Did anybody notice?
I'm sure. I don't know. I'm sure people did. I mean, there would have been like a second or two where they couldn't hear the guitar. And then I brought it up to the mic and they couldn't hear the guitar. And then... You know, they obviously see some guy dressed in all black, like running out with a headset and changing the battery. I'm sure people noticed, but fortunately the song I'm sure sounded somewhat okay through all of that.
You're telling this story and here I am. I've got technical difficulties right here. I'm running on a battery backup right now.
The show must go on. I've had it where I'm singing and in a smaller venue and there's like bagpipers that just decide to like walk down our street. And fortunately it happened to be in the key of the song that I was playing. And so I just kept going and it was fine. And then I was like, I didn't realize I had a bagpipe backup band.
Oh, there we go.
Oh, hey, power's back on. Back. There we go. Lovely.
Yeah. We powered through it, man. So you reminded me of this story. I'm going to share it with you. Mm-hmm. I think I told it, I was interviewing Anthony Rosano, of Anthony Rosano and the Conquerors, like a couple of years back. Right. And we were talking blues and I was playing, I'm a music hobbyist, right? Like I have my guitars and things like that. I don't consider myself an artist because I'm just not at the level of someone like you even, right? Like you're at this, like, you know, up here and I'm like, you know, I just strum, I strum like five chords, right? And I just move them around a bit. But I'm at my work and they say, you know, can you work this charity event? Can you do a couple of songs? I'm like, yeah, all right, no problem. It's a Christmas charity, you know, collecting money and stuff like that. So I'm out there and I've only played in front of an audience maybe twice before. Mm-hmm. And maybe I wasn't as prepared, but anyways, I'm playing a song and I'm strumming through the guitar and I'm singing and the pick goes flying out of my hand.
Oh yeah.
And I don't have any picks nearby.
Right.
And I could see it. It's on the floor and I'm not really good with my hand. So I do this thing where I strum down with my hand. I'm going to start bleeding, I figure, with my fingers. But I strum, swoop down to the floor, grab the pick, come back up and start and keep going. And for the most part, nobody really noticed except a couple of people off to the side. They were like looking at me like, is he bleeding?
Yeah. But, no, you know, totally. Yeah. This is why guitar players always have extra picks.
Yeah, well, yeah, you know, like in retrospect, I had a box of picks. They just weren't in front of me or on my stand or anything either.
Yeah, they get one of those little like holders and it holds a bunch of them and they your guitar and then you can just pull another one out. Great. So I don't do that though. I have like these picks that like I've always played with a thumb pick, so it like attaches to your thumb.
No, like I got them here. Like I got these. I like a cat tongue pick, you know. I don't know if you the cat tongues.
Right.
Those are my favorite.
Right.
They have a little bit of a rasp to them.
Yeah.
And they're called cat tongues. Those are my go-to picks. And the kids here at home, my favorite one is my purple one.
Yeah.
And one of my kids, like, she always steals these, like they're gone, and because she likes the color purple. Mm-hmm. So anyways, pick stories.
Purple's my favorite color too, so.
Are you serious?
Got something in common. Yeah.
There you go. Yeah. She just steals it. She likes the purple ones. Yeah. I even wrote a little jingle about my purple pick because she always steals my purple picks. But
yeah.
Anyways, enough of my stories. You recently released a single called That Was Then, This Is Now.
Yes.
It's a song that's going to be on your debut album called Nice Guy, which is scheduled for release on July 14th, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
So congrats on the single and the forthcoming album.
Thank you.
Can you tell us a little bit about the album? How many songs, overall theme, guest appearances, song insights?
Yeah. So it's 10 songs. Unless you can make it to a show, I am selling the deluxe USB edition, which has 4 extra songs on it.
Oh,
they're exclusive to the USB stick version.
Are you gonna let us know what those 4 extra songs are, or is that like club only?
Club only. You gotta buy the USB.
All right. Club only. Gotta buy the USB. At the shows.
At the shows. You can only buy them at the shows. Until they run out. I got 100 copies.
Okay.
And then otherwise it's 10 songs. The only feature is actually the one that I just put out. So the rest are 100% Josh Bogert, front to back. And I think they're like the most honest songs I've probably ever released. I think I went through a lot of time trying to like make songs that I thought would be cool, as opposed to making songs that, you know, I wanted to, that I just liked, you know, like, I think that's what this album is songs that I really like and I wanted to make. And, that's, I guess, the overall theme of it. Most of them are love songs, or breakup songs. That's generally what I'm usually write about. Breaking up with my toxic ex and meeting my lovely girlfriend. Those are the main kind of subjects.
So are you taking us through a transition on the album then, or?
I think so. Yeah. I mean, the previous EP project was very like very electronic for sure. This one is a bit more like, I think, an all-encompassing Josh Bogert album. It's like it's got the slower, more ballady songs. It's got the upbeat stuff with the electronic elements, but very like purposeful in the writing, very intentional. Mm-hmm. Everything was like, you know, there's a specific purpose for every word in that album. There's not anything in there to fill any space, which I think took me a while to figure out. It's like sometimes less is more. You know, if there's even sounds, like I'm producing the song, it's like if I'm putting a sound in to fill space, it's not the right sound. I gotta, like, it's gotta have a purpose. And so I think every note, every word, everything has a purpose in this album. And I think it's a bit of like a transitional, you know, album. I think it's also just very much like a This Is Who I Am album, if that makes sense. I'm calling it season three just because it's kind of the third project that I've done. I did my initial EP just called Josh Bogert, and then I did Perspectives, which was 2020, and all the singles leading up to that. And then most of the singles that have come out since then are kind of leading up to this third project. So yeah, it's like the third era of Josh Bogert, I guess.
Is it a bit of a reboot?
Perhaps. Yeah.
Yeah. Are you the nice guy?
That's the idea. That was the original name for the album, actually. That's what we were going to call it. Management thought it was great. I was like, yeah, I want to be nice, but I also don't necessarily want to call my album Nice Guy, because I feel like that has, I don't know, people would judge quite quickly before they hear the music. They're like, oh, this is a wimp. but no, one of the songs is called Nice Guy. And that's because, you know, I definitely have faced that, like as a kid growing up. It's like, it was always important to me to be nice to people. And I was also focused on my music. I didn't party a lot. I didn't, like, you know, do all the cool stuff. And so I wasn't the cool guy. I was the nice guy. And I don't know. I want people that are the nice guy to feel like it can be cool to be that, you know, I guess. So that was going to be the name of the album.
I'm connecting with that nice guy, right? And cool guy. I can go for that.
Yeah.
Look, you alluded to all the other songs are just Josh. That was then. This is now. You feature Olivia Penalva on it.
Yes.
You connected with Olivia through fellow songwriter Andrew Allen. Mm-hmm. You both sound great on the song. And if folks haven't checked it out, it's now spinning on our affiliate station, The Path Radio. Mm-hmm. So that's been getting spins there. Yep. It's also, you've got it out on Spotify as well. Mm-hmm. Other than Andrew, what brought you and Olivia together to say, yeah, we're going to collaborate on this, or this is us, this is what we're going to do together?
I think it was very much actually like I had heard her music. I knew of her. I didn't know if she knew of me. I just wanted to write something with her because I thought her stuff was great. So, and I knew Andrew knew her. So I was like, hey, can you set up the session? So I basically, you know, was just like, yeah, let's do it. And then, anyway, we got in the session. We wrote this song. It was like the first time we had ever written together. We wrote this song.
Oh, and wow.
The three of us together wrote it. And, we all loved it right away. It was like, yeah, this is a great song. It needs to go somewhere. And then it just took a while, like, you know, with different management teams and changes happening and, you know, labels getting involved on her side. And it just, you know, it had to line up. So it was a couple of years. And then I was putting together this album. I was like, I'd really like to include the song. And she was like, yeah, I'm definitely in a position where we can do that. And I'll get it all cleared and we're good to go. So.
So that's awesome. So big deal. It happens. You guys collaborate and we've got a gem of a song out there for folks to consume. Now, the song itself, origins, meaning, personal insights.
Yeah. Honestly, I'm trying to remember like who came up with like the concept. I also feel like this is one of those songs where the concept happened as we were writing it. Like we started writing, which is usually not how I work. Usually I know exactly what the song's going to be about. Yeah. And then I start writing it. But no, it was like we had this cool guitar riff and then we were kind of just spitting out lyrics and creating this story. And then we figured out, oh, this is what it's going to be about. But I think for me, it's like it's very clear to me now how much things can change in relationships. Like you can feel so strongly one way in a relationship for a good amount of time. And then a couple of years later, you look back on that and go, wow. I'm such a different person. They are such a different person. And that could never be what this is now, but also you're kind of like, I wish I could go back there, perhaps, right? Or maybe you're not. Maybe you're like, good thing I'm out of that. But no, I think that's what the song represents to me 100% is like how much that can change and how people can grow out of something. And even though it was good in one time when you were in that situation, it's not necessarily the right thing at a different time, you know?
Josh, do you, with some of the earlier stuff that you wrote, do you ever look back at it and want to change anything of your songs or your music?
I don't think so. The only thing I would say is like my first EP, I do wish I was more involved in it. That first EP was co-written. I didn't produce any of it. And the guy I co-wrote it with and who produced it was phenomenal. He did a great job. But yeah, I wish I had been more involved because I was a kid and I wasn't as, I guess as determined to like, I wasn't as, I guess, I don't know the word, like I wasn't in there. You know what I mean? I think I could have been, I stood my ground a little bit more and been like, I want to like be a part of this more so. And I mean, the songs are great. They did really well. And so I'm happy about that. And I don't think if I did change it, who knows what would happen. Right. So I don't necessarily think I would, but there is definitely a little bit of that, like, you know, everything since then, I was like, I'm producing it. I'm writing it or co-writing it. And it was just important to me to like tell my story, you know?
Now you must take an experience like that and apply it. Like if you're producing or working with somebody else, you must give that thought to that person now, right? Having those experiences.
Yeah.
You're going on tour. You're doing a tour in May. You're going to Los Angeles, San Francisco, Oakland, Portland, Seattle, Vancouver, I think.
West Coast. Oh my gosh. I'm playing music by accident. Sorry.
No, it's all good. I mean, hey, like
those are all sorts of songs. It's on my unreleased playlist. Oh my gosh. I'm leaking my own music here.
Oh, bootleg. Josh yeah. Moger bootleg right on the show.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. That was close. Sorry. Yes, I'm going on tour.
I just, you know what? I think we just got the four extra that are on the USB only.
There you go. Leaked. Oh my gosh.
All right, right on. So yeah, you're doing like a tour. You're heading out. You're doing the tour thing.
I'm super excited for it. And I was kind of like nervous because I'm going into the States and I don't know if, you know, for people that don't know as a Canadian going to play in the States is a pain because of all the paperwork and visas and stuff and how much time it takes to get that stuff. So it's a bit of a crunch, but it's all set. I'm leaving on, on Monday.
Right.
This fall, Monday. And, my first show is on May 17th in LA. Going up through San Francisco, Oakland, Portland, and Seattle. And then I got a date in Vancouver at the end as well.
Right on. And then are you planning on doing another tour after the album comes out or?
I think we'll see. I mean, it's hard to say. I don't know. Because part of me, like once the album's out and I'm promoting it like in Toronto and stuff and
yeah.
Doing shows there and then on social media and everything. I think there's going to be a big online push. And then after that, I think I'm going to really want to like focus on writing and just kind of creating for a bit. Cause it's been a while since I've been able to be in that headspace. Like it kind of goes through stages where you write a whole bunch of songs and produce them. And then it goes into this kind of stage of like filming music videos and talking to graphic designers about cover art and, you know, booking shows and making content for social media and all of that stuff.
Getting it out,
releasing it, which isn't really making the music, which is the most of what I, you know, the reason why I do music is to make music. I think I'm going to want to kind of take a step back and focus on what's coming next. But who knows? I mean, if stuff starts really popping off and it makes sense to do a tour, then it'll be something that I'll look into.
Now, I think we said at the top of the show, you are here in Toronto, Canadian Music Week. Mm-hmm. You're going to be performing?
Yes.
Yeah, you're going to be performing.
June 7th, I think.
Yeah, I have here somewhere, and I don't want to mess around with my computer given the technical glitches we had earlier. But yep. I have your schedule somewhere over there. So
I just made a post for it, and I think it's June 7th.
June 7th? Right on. So if folks in the area want to check that out, I'll put that in the show notes or whatever. Look, I'm thankful that you came here and we've had this chat. I've had a lot of laughs and overcome some of the challenges.
It's been great.
I'm pretty excited and pumped for your album and your music.
Thank you.
And for your career overall, you know, as an international artist, you know, with Canadian roots, you know, as a fellow Canadian, it means a lot to me and to Canadians when we see someone like you, you know, succeeding and being an inspiration to others as they're trying to find their craft too. So thank you for doing this. Thank you for putting up with some of the technical difficulties. Is there anything that you'd like to leave us with before I let you get back to your craft?
Yeah, I mean, I think the only thing I want to say is to everyone that's listening is, you know, just try and do something nice for somebody today or tonight or whenever you're listening to this. Like, kind is the new cool. That's my motto. So yeah, just do something nice and that's it.
So that is the nice guy, the cool guy with purpose. Is Josh Bogert, actor, musician, producer, continuing his journey as a rising star in the music industry. His debut album is coming out in July. His new song, That Was Then, This Is Now, can be heard now. And we're going to get to hear that on the show a bit later, so stay tuned. I will have all of Josh's social media links in the show notes. Thank you again, Josh. Keep on rocking and take care.
Thank you.
How about we get to that music right now? Here is Josh Bogert featuring Olivia Penalva with his song That Was Then, This Is Now.
Just a couple friends hanging out when you walked in, and now that I see your face, I remember our last good weekend. We could barely make it through the front door with our sunny chill, and we couldn't even speak, and now we don't talk anymore. I know you know.
That was then, and this is now, and it is now. And that's Josh Bogert featuring Olivia Penalva with his brand new song. and his new album coming out in July, so stay tuned for that. Folks, let's get to our next segment. But before we do that, let's hear from one of our friends of the podcast. Here's Richard at Chaser's Juice.
Hi, I'm Richard Chase, introducing Chaser's Fresh Juice, a local business in Toronto. We've been in business for over 20 years, initially supporting our local Toronto area and now servicing all of Canada. Chaser provides fresh organic juices, ingredients, including citrus zests, dehydrated garnishes, and fresh citrus peels to enhance any cocktail or recipe you can think of. We have successfully supplied restaurants, distilleries, craft breweries, and bakeries across the country. Reach out to orders@chasersjuice.com for any questions you may have. We are a customized fresh juice company, and I'm sure we can help you. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard at Chasers Juice, who is also a friend of thepathradio.com, which you can now hear across all Alexa devices just by saying, "Alexa, play The Path Radio." All right, let's keep the show rolling to our next guest. I've got inspirational speaker and author Lynn Ray. We're going to talk about mental health, bipolar disorder, depression, and how she overcame it. She's got a really interesting story, folks. Hope you enjoy this segment. I know I did with Lynn, so let's get to it.
Thank you for joining us today. We have Lynn Ray with us here on the Monthly Social. Lynn is an author, success coach, and inspirational speaker. But those are not the only reasons you want to tune in. Lynn Ray was diagnosed with depression at the age of 30 and bipolar disorder at 35. After being told she would never work full-time again, she went on to achieve more than what the psychiatrists and doctors ever expected or told her that she would. How did she do that? Let's find that out and more. Lynn, thank you for being here today. How are you?
Thank you very much for having me, Guido. It's a real pleasure to be here.
Oh, mine too. And look, it's my pleasure to have you here. You're my neighbor. We just found out.
That's right.
Right? You're a new market. Can we use the term new marketer? Is new marketing? Is it what
new marketonian? I'm not sure what they call it.
We've insulted all the people in New Market and we haven't been on the air for 15 seconds. New Marketonians, maybe? I don't know.
Our logo is shop local since the pandemic.
Is that, that's the slogan?
Yeah. Shop local.
Is it working?
For me, it is. I barely have to leave New Market for anything I need.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, I'm in my little world here, not that far away from you in Richmond Hill, so everything's pretty, and just Oak Ridges is like right up the road as well, yeah. Right? Yeah, I love Oak Ridges. It's great. What a great area it is, eh?
Oh, there's trails all over the place. You can go walking in, yeah. Biking. If you just drive 10 or 20 miles outside of town, not even that far, there's trails all over the place for walking. Take your dogs.
Yeah. I think we get a lot of visitors now in the area that are not local to our towns that have discovered the trails and all the beautiful parts of it. So
yeah, people wanting to get out of Toronto for the day. I know that.
Well, they're welcome here and just be respectful, right? Just be respectful of the lands that we have and enjoy it that way. Lynn, so we're going to get into a whole bunch of stuff with you and talk about courageous conversations and the things that we're going to get into. Maybe if we could establish some foundation, can you tell us a little bit about the time in your life leading to your diagnosis of depression and bipolar disorder?
Sure. I was leading the middle class life. I got married young, and then we had two children when I was in my 20s. I'd been working full time, and then I stopped work to be a full time mother. So, like I said, I was living the middle class life. We had a nice home in Keswick. We lived at the time, or, you know, a middle class style of house. My husband had a good paying job. And I thought everything was fine. And then one day, tears started coming, and I didn't know why. And almost every day for a few weeks, I would have tears, and I didn't know what I was crying about. And I went to my doctor, and he said, "What's wrong with you? You've got a great life, healthy kids, nice home." So I found another doctor, and she referred me to a psychiatrist, and that's when I was diagnosed with depression. So what I did is I took antidepressants, and within 6 weeks, I felt great again. But fast forward 4 years, they were giving me too much energy. I couldn't sit still, so I stopped taking them. And a few months after I stopped taking them, I had a breakdown and ended up in the hospital. So it was these tears that led to the depression, and it took me a long time to figure out what they were about. What I found out later is I remember weeks leading up to my wedding, something didn't feel right in my gut, and I had nobody to talk to. I thought it was just pre-wedding jitters. And then even on our honeymoon, this is a terrible thought. I thought about getting our marriage annulled. And I told myself, no, I'm married. I'm going to be happy. And I believe I was happy for 10 years. And then like I was living this lie, like it, in my unconscious, I really didn't want to be married. Consciously, I thought I was happy doing everything right. But living this life finally caught up to me. And I couldn't deny anymore that our marriage wasn't working. When two people come together, you either grow together or grow apart. And we grew apart right from day one. You know, we were like oil and water. We just didn't mix. You know, there was no big thing going on that I could put my finger on. So, like I said, I thought I had the middle class life leading up to all of this.
So, Lynn, what was your initial reaction to the diagnosis when you're presented with, well, you have depression? I don't know if you were presented with bipolar disorder at the, like you said, within that 5 year span, but maybe that came afterwards. Either way, what was your initial reaction to either of those diagnoses? And then, you know, what did you do in the immediate time after? Like you say, well, I started taking some of the medications, but did you accept it right away? Did you wonder what if? Like what was going on in terms of, you know, getting that diagnosis?
When I was diagnosed with depression, I was very embarrassed to tell anybody that. Only two people knew I was taking an antidepressant, my husband and a girlfriend. I wouldn't tell anyone in our family. It was 1990 and mental health wasn't being talked about yet. And I wasn't diagnosed with bipolar until I had two breakdowns. You know, they kind of have to observe you to see how you react to things and what your moods are like. Like bipolar disorder is an exaggeration of emotions. You have these emotional highs or lows. And I started having them. The first time I was hospitalized, I was paranoid, I was psychotic. There were all these strange things going around in my head. But I have to tell you, I was telling all the doctors and nurses, the truth shall set you free. The truth shall set you free. And that's how they knew there was something going on in my brain that I was denying. And it was at my third hospitalization, the nurses finally made me realize a big part of my problem was my marriage. They started asking me questions about family, volunteer work, my kids, my friends. And they said I had to tell the truth. And I thought, this is weird. I don't lie. I always tell the truth. And then they asked me how my marriage was. And I hesitated for about 3 seconds and replied, fine. At that very instant, I could feel something move in my brain right there. And I told myself, uh-oh, I just told a lie. I don't know how I know that. I don't have any kind of degrees in science or medical degrees, but I knew immediately I had told this lie. So that's how I came to the conclusion finally that I had to leave my marriage. Because like I said, there was no outward signs of trouble. It was just, we weren't a good match.
So you had some foundations in whatever that experience was that was sort of starting to materialize in your depression and your bipolar behavior, if I can call it that. And maybe this is a good time to ask this. Not everyone understands what depression or bipolar disorder is, its range, and there's certainly a range to it, or what it means. You've given us some examples of your marriage, but you know, outside of that, what's an average day like, for you? You mentioned the low moments. What's an average day for someone with depression or bipolar disorder when you have those low moments?
Those low moments for me involve laying on the couch. I might be crying or I might just be kind of numb. I have no desire to get up and do things or live life like everybody else does. I still manage to eat all the time, unfortunately. But for me, it was a lot of just lying on the couch, numb, in tears, because I didn't want to live life. I just felt like I didn't have anything to look forward to. And that happened after I left my marriage too. I want to be clear. Things didn't resolve themselves immediately. I had to do a lot of work on myself.
Did you stay in those low moments for a long time?
Yeah. What I usually found is the lows would usually last about between 4 and 6 months, usually. Wow. I would make myself go out and do volunteer work, but I wouldn't be able to work full time. Sometimes I could work part time. But yeah, they were very, very low, the lows.
And when you say, well, I would go and do this work or something, did you have to build yourself up to go out and do that stuff? Like, was it a big task to get out and do it?
Not really, because I'm a very responsible person. And if I tell somebody I'm going to be there, I'm going to be there. It gave me a reason to get up and going. We all need a reason to get up in the morning, right? Whether it's to let the dog out, take care of our kids, go to work. We all need a reason to get up. And I felt like I had no reason.
Yeah, so this wasn't a lazy, rainy Sunday afternoon. This was a longer period of time.
Oh, months, yes. The depression lasts for months.
I understand that you managed to learn how to live with this illness effectively, I think is the words. And what exactly does that mean? What are the things that you needed to do to learn how to live with depression and bipolar disorder?
Well, like I said, I had to do a lot of work on myself. I reached out to support for support within the mental health system, whatever was available at the time. I remember going to a support for depression group on and off for a few years, and I haven't needed that group in 20 years.
Oh, wow.
Because, yeah, like I started going to it in about 1995, and I went to it for 5, 6, 7 years, maybe, off and on. But like I said, I don't need that support now. I have girlfriends for support. I have my daughter and my son. So like I said, I relied on the mental health system. There was a time I had a social worker that I saw every month, and she was really good to talk to. I tell people that have mental health struggles, especially depression, PTSD, you really need to talk through your issues. It is important to find a therapist or social worker to talk to. And I saw my psychiatrist on a regular basis, and I still see a psychiatrist every 3 months just to check in and make sure everything's okay. I read a lot of books about mental health, depression, bipolar disorder. I read self-help books. I've got well over 200 self-help motivational books in my library. One of the biggest ones that made a difference to me early on was when I say no, I feel guilty, because I had been a people pleaser. And once I figured out I didn't have to say yes to everybody, all of a sudden, Lynn is becoming a different person. And yes, I was becoming a different person. But the person I was wasn't functioning, so I had to become a different person. And another one that made an impact on me is called boundaries. I realized I could decide who to let into my close circle of friends. You don't tell everybody everything, because everybody doesn't have your best interests at heart. So those were two books, and I clung to these words. I'm a big fan of motivational sayings, and I came across these words in a book by Deepak Chopra. You can believe the diagnosis, not the prognosis. I tell people, whatever label you are given, yes, doctors have to give it a label to put us in their chart, right? But whatever label you are given, don't define yourself by it. You and only you are in charge of your present circumstances and future. So like I said, I would read that saying hundreds of times a day. You can believe the diagnosis, not the prognosis. And that's true for any illness, physical or mental.
And you're sharing it with others on a regular basis when you get the opportunity to. Now, Lynn, you said, look, when I got diagnosed with this, I was a little bit embarrassed, you know, maybe not wanting to talk to anybody or anything, but you ended up going to some support groups. When you went to the support groups, is that where you realized that the people in your circle that you could talk to, that it was, you know, your some family members and certain friends? Was that the stepping stone to be able to say, yeah, I can go talk to those folks in my life? Or do I even identify them?
In the support group, people identified with what I was going through. I have never had a long, drawn-out conversation with my siblings or parents about this. Yes, they came to see me when I was in the hospital. They were very helpful. My mother and mother-in-law babysat my kids. I'm not close to my family anyways, okay? We're not a real close family where we talk about things. And no, I relied on strangers to talk to. I would call a crisis line when I was in a crisis. and talk to the social worker on the phone. I have one aunt. She has been my biggest supporter. I can talk to her about things. But like I said, in my family, we don't talk about it all the time. So it's just a non-issue for me.
Now, Lynn, look, you said when we were talking about you coming here and doing the show, you said one of the things you want to be on the show is your goal is to give others hope that in spite of setbacks, that they can have a rich, satisfying life.
Yes.
Has that become part of your pillars for progress? And if it has, how has it?
Well, what I tell other people is taking a pill will not cure anything. The cure for any illness, physical or mental, is 25% medication and 75% working on yourself and your issues. You know, if you have high blood pressure, you can lose weight to help with that. If you're diabetic, you can change your diet to help with that. If you're overweight, you can change your diet and exercise to help with that. My life has been one of lifelong learning. I'm always coming up with new ideas about things I can do to improve my life. I came up with 7 words, all starting with the letter F, that led to my recovery. And one of them is fitness. My mental fitness is fine, but physical fitness, that is the hardest for me to achieve. I'm a single woman. I like to eat. I have a sweet tooth. You know, I'm a work in progress, just like everybody else is. So like I said, I tell people that it doesn't matter what challenges they're facing, you can overcome them. You need to do the work on yourself. If you want a magic pill, yeah, it can elevate your mood, to make you feel good, but that's not getting to the root of the problem. And people don't want to hear that it's going to take work, but I'm honest and straightforward about things.
So you've mentioned fitness and you've mentioned the 7 F's. I imagine one of the tools that you've used for helping others and yourself is the book that you've authored called the F book. Can you give us a little bit more insight on what that F book is?
Yeah, about 15 years ago, when I could finally say, yes, I have learned to manage bipolar disorder, I realized there were 7 words, all starting with the letter F, that led to my recovery. They are family, friends, fun, fitness, fulfillment, finances, and faith. And what I tell people is when I left my marriage, I started making friends and having fun again, and that increased the happiness chemicals in my brain, such as serotonin and dopamine. And that's how I got out of the depression on a permanent basis, is because I make sure I have something fun to do every day. It might be only a few minutes playing solitaire on the computer. It might be reading for 20 minutes. It might be talking to a friend on the phone. It might be knitting. But I do something fun and relaxing every single day for myself. And I've got friends in my life. I have a lot of acquaintances, but I have very few close friends. But I see my children and grandson on a regular basis. So that's the family part. Friends, fun. And I make sure my mental fitness is always in check. I do deep breathing. I make sure I'm grounded. I just make sure that I'm doing the things I need every day to keep mentally fit. Fulfillment is anything that you love to do. It leaves you with a deep sense of joy. It could be volunteer work. It could be caring for a grandchild. It could be a hobby that you love doing, woodworking, skiing, golfing, anything that leaves you with a deep sense of fulfillment. And finances, we all have money that we have to manage. And I went through a lot of money when I was on these emotional highs. One of the things you do quite often is go on these wild spending sprees because you're just living so much in the moment. You're not thinking about the future. So I got deeply in debt. And when I was finally able to work full-time again, I got out of debt. Every spare dollar I had went to paying off debt. When I got out of debt, a year later, I bought a house. And I've been living here for 11 years, and I am so thankful. I've had to have boarders to help pay the bills. But that's in the past. I'm not going to have a boarder anymore. Fingers crossed. So like I said, money is important to everybody. Yeah, I say we have to give ourselves a small pleasure every day and week. For some people, that might mean buying a coffee or tea on the way to work. It might be going out for dinner once a week or going to a movie. You know, I'm not a Scrooge where you just save, save, save. I like to spend money too, but I save money on necessities so I have money for the things I want to do.
So Lynn, congratulations on the progress that you made. It sounds like you're living you're living your 7 F's. Like these are lived experiences that you've now translated into a book to help others. You know, they're your personal real life experiences. Did you have to think about the 7 F's, or did it just come naturally to you as you sat down and said, you know what, this is what they are, right? You know, like these are the things that I've done. Did that just come naturally to you as you're preparing to put the book together?
No, 4 of them came naturally. Family, friends, fun, and fitness. That came naturally. And then I thought, okay, everything is like this 7 habits of highly effective people. Well, it's always 7, right? Because that's kind of the lucky number, yeah. Whatever. So I thought, okay, what else can I add? So faith was the first thing I added to my F's because I have a very strong faith. And then I needed 2 more. And I wanted something around money because it's something we all have to learn to manage. So finances was the only word I could come up with about money. And fulfillment, at first it was forte, F-O-R-T-E, like something you excel at or you're good at. And then I thought, no, I wanted fulfillment, just something that gives you an abundance of joy and makes your heart feel full when you're doing it. You don't have to be good at it, just enjoy it.
It's almost like a bit of a wrapper for all of these other things that you had come up with. Lynn, one of the passages in your book reads, perfection only exists in people's minds. We can never achieve it. Now, look, some might read that and say that it sounds like you're giving up, but can you give us some larger context on what you're telling us in that segment with those words?
Don't be too hard on yourself. We all make mistakes. And there's a quote by the late Maya Angelou. She said, you did the best you knew how to do at the time. And when you knew better, you did better. And I had to leave my children with my husband because I couldn't care for them when I left our marriage. You know, that was devastating for me. I did the best I could from a distance and with the information I was being given. But looking back, I would have done things a lot different.
Yeah, you know, and I guess when I read that in the context too, I thought sometimes we strive to portray something that isn't real, is hard to live, isn't us, right? Because we have a vision of what perfect might be, and just the challenge in trying to live up to something like that for friends, family, those we think that are judging us, maybe even, you know. Lynn, in the family part of your book, you go on to say this. That was definitely the case in my family. Somebody would hurt my feelings if they said something negative about something I was doing. I would feel angry, but didn't express that anger in an open, respectful way. Most of the time, my anger got buried deep within my unconscious. But sometimes I would explode over some seemingly minor issues. Now, looking back on that, Lynn, were those controllable moments, given what you knew later about depression and bipolar disorder? Or were those moments the moments that led to either of those conditions developing further?
Well, I didn't know how to communicate my negative thoughts in a open, honest way, and neither did my husband. We just didn't know how to communicate to resolve issues when we had differences of opinion. So they just got swept under the carpet. We never talked about them. And then one of us would get mad over some stupid thing like the garbage didn't get taken out or something, you know. But really, it was the 50 things that happened before that that led up to that problem.
Right.
Like I said, I wasn't a good communicator, and maybe I'm still not. I'm better with the written word. I know that because then I could change it 20 times to say exactly what I want to say in my head.
Right. It gives you that little bit of time to think it through and whatnot. So do you think things like that contributed to the depression in any way?
Probably, yes, because like I said, you're not resolving things as they come up. They just get pushed aside, and then you're on overload, and your mind can't take even small little problems.
Right. Lynn, you tell another story about your relationship with your mom. You hadn't hugged for 14 years since your wedding day. Then you get together for a lunch. You talk and you go through some history, and you both come out of that conversation, you say, feeling better. But it's ultimately not what you wanted in terms of a friendship with your mom. And I am sorry to hear, I learned that, you know, she passed in 2004. But how do you look back on that lunch now and put it into perspective of where you are in life now?
To me, the 5 hours we spent that day were very cleansing. I was actually on a hypomanic high that day. I didn't realize it because it was the week I was hospitalized. But for some reason, we were able to communicate that day. And I have no idea what we talked about now. I haven't the foggiest. But I remember the feeling of warmth or love or something. being communicated between us. And, you know, there's a saying, it takes a journey, or it takes a village to raise a child. My mother taught me discipline, time management, a lot of things, respect for other people, integrity, don't lie. You know, she taught me so many things, but those soft skills were not her strong point, you know. I couldn't go to her when I was having a bad day as a teenager. You know, she was a good listener to her grandchildren, but to her children, it was different.
Would she look at you differently now, you think?
Oh, I'm sure she would, yes.
Yeah.
I could see in the years following that interaction, she was very, very proud of me. But to say it openly, like I said, those things just didn't happen in our family.
Now, Lynn, earlier you talked about one of the F's in your book was to have fun. Did you have to learn how to have fun again? And I'm thinking of this because you have the conversation with your mom. There's a learning experience there. You're talking about, you know, certain emotions and how you can openly communicate, the types of relationship you've had with people along the way. Did you have to learn how to have fun again before you had fun?
I had to relearn what was fun for me. When I met my husband, I used to go dancing with friends every single weekend, every Friday and Saturday night, we were dancing. When I met him, I gave that up because he didn't want to go. So you see, I changed who I was to make our relationship work. I think he changed who he was to make our relationship work. So you end up with two strangers living together.
And the two people that met aren't there.
That's right.
Yeah.
And when I left my marriage, about a year later, I found a social group for single people over 30 in Newmarket. And I just started doing everything with them. We'd go to a pub for dinner. We went horseback riding, camping, whitewater rafting, dancing. There, I found out there were dances for singles over 30. And that just brought me so much joy because I felt like I was a teenager again when I went to those dances.
Lynn, tell us a little bit about what you're doing as an inspirational speaker, and who would be your ideal audience or even client?
Well, my ideal audience is people wanting to make changes in their life. I would say over 30, 30 to 50, 55 age range. You don't have to have a mental illness to benefit from these 7 F words. We all need them in our lives. So my ideal audience, like I said, would be mostly women over 30. They're the people that are going to be most receptive to this kind of thing.
And are these like in a group setting, or are these one-on-one sessions? Or,
well, I do inspirational talks. I've been doing them at Rotary Clubs, a couple of mental health places. I did a couple at libraries last fall. I just did Habitat for Humanity this week on Zoom.
Congratulations.
Yeah. Thank you. Companies have lunch and learns. Ideally, I want to start getting into companies for lunch and learns. You know, because I'm speaking about mental health.
Yeah.
And companies need to make sure their employees stay mentally healthy. And I do one-on-one coaching.
I was just going to ask, you also provide success coach services, right? Is that?
Yes, but yeah. It's based on my 7 F's. What we do is go, the first session is to just kind of an overview of all 7 F's and what the client's goals are. And then they read the first chapter, family, and there's a workbook that goes along with it. That they can do the exercises in, and then we come back and we talk about family. And then 2 or 3 weeks later, we do friends, and we keep going through them. I recommend taking 4 to 6 months to do it, so you have time to implement any changes you want to make in your life.
So they read the book, plus you have a workbook, and then you're guiding them through in the personal coach portion of your service.
Yes.
Right on. And where do folks find your book or get in touch with you from a social media account perspective?
My book is for sale on Amazon, and it's called The F Book, 7 F's to Creating Your Fantastic Future. And the workbook is just called the 7 F's workbook. So that's for sale on Amazon. And my website is myjourneybacktomyself.ca. I'm on Facebook and LinkedIn under My Journey Back to Myself. On both of the... I have a business page. So that's where they can find me for the most part. I'm going to chapters now that they're through their cyber attack. Oh, we keep going to chapters in May. I think it's Ajax.
Oh, right on.
And I've been to a couple health and wellness fairs to promote myself, so I get out in the community as much as I can.
Are you also doing stuff on YouTube or TikTok? Or
I've started doing these little mental health minutes. They're okay. Only up to 2 minutes long, and I just post it once a week on YouTube and put it on Facebook and LinkedIn as well.
Okay, so we've got your books are on Amazon. MyJourneyBackToMyself.ca. You've got you just started some content on Facebook and on YouTube, and you're sharing it on Facebook and LinkedIn as well. So I'll make sure that we get all of those links. We'll put them in the show notes for everybody so that they can access them and they'll be able to contact you. I do want to thank you for coming on the show, and you know, you're sharing your life with your life experiences with us. And I know there are probably some examples in the book, but it's a lot different when you do it in this format, and if people see you and they identify with you. They put a face to the book and hear your voice and the personal experiences. So thank you so much for doing that. And it's a very sincere conversation that you had with us. Is there anything that you would like to leave us with before you go that maybe I didn't touch on it or that you'd want to say of any kind?
About a month ago, I believe it was a podcast interview. The woman asked me, do I practice what I preach? And I probably rolled my eyes because I said, yes, of course I do. I'm not going to tell anyone to do anything that that hasn't worked for me. I'm telling people this worked for me. It might work for you. It might not. But this is what works for me for my life. So I try not to be a hypocrite. Many years ago, I said I wasn't going to be a hypocrite with my kids when I quit smoking. You know, I walk my talk 99% of the time. I'm never going to say 100 because nobody's perfect.
Yeah. So that is Lynn Ray. Doesn't start with an F, but she's authentic. She's an inspirational speaker, a success coach, author, mother, friend, and survivor. Diagnosed with depression at the age of 30 and bipolar disorder at 35, she has persevered and is achieving life goals her doctors never thought she would. I will have all of Lynn's contact information in the podcast notes and links to her book in the podcast merchandise store as well. Thank you so much, Lynn. I wish you the best. I hope to talk to you soon, and take care.
Okay, thanks for having me, Guido.
We are now making our way closer to our segment with John Cusimano. But before we do that, let's hear from one of our friends at the podcast, Lee's Fine Cars.
Whether it's buying a new car or a quick oil change, Lee's Fine Cars and Service Center has got you covered. Proudly serving the GTA for over 30 years as your one-stop automotive source for sales, service, and bodywork. Come visit us at 87 Green Lane, conveniently located just south of Bayview and 407, or online at leesfinecars.com.
So earlier I was talking about barbecuing, and I had posted online a picture of one of the steaks I cooked on the new barbecue. And so some questions had started to come in. So I wrote an article over on guidoprano.com, how to pick, marinate, and barbecue the perfect steak. And if you go there and you go to the article section, I have a whole list of ingredients that you would need for the marinade. I talk about how you tenderize your steak, how you prepare the steak, how you cook the steak. I've got some step-by-step instructions and pictures, and even how you serve the steak. Anyways, this marinade and these instructions provide information on how to make a medium-rare type of steak. And the cool thing about this marinade is you can use it on any type of quality steak that you want to use it on. And I have some alternate ingredients there that I suggest as well. So if you are looking at, hey, you know what? I want to do a steak. I want to try something different. This is a great marinade. It is an overnight marinade, but it's a great marinade. And every time I've served the steaks after marinating them and cooking them this way, everybody has loved them. So if you try it, let me know how it turns out. All right. Look, before we get to our next guest, John Cusimano, Fastest Land Animals, I want to listen to one of his songs. So let's listen to the song, and then we'll get to talking with John. All right, here we go. Here is John Cusimano, Fastest Land Animal, with Next to You.
Yeah.
now that we're all tuned up with Fastest Land Animal and John Cusimano, let's go have a chat with him.
Thanks for joining us today with special guest John Cusimano. He's a lawyer, mixologist, actor, producer, author, and with his band Fastest Land Animal, a lyricist, vocalist, and guitarist, alongside bandmates Andrew Meskin on drums, Johnny Blaze on guitar and bass. He is the jack and master of many trades. Welcome to the show, John. Thank you for taking the time to be here with me to talk music, life, and whatever else we come up with today. How you doing?
I'm doing well. I don't know if I would add actor to my list of things that I do.
No.
I've been on TV a lot because of my wife's show, but I'm not really acting. I'm just acting like an idiot. Acting like myself.
I don't know, man. You look good on TV. Like, you know, that's what my mother tells me anyways.
Tell your mom. Here she goes. I'm paying her off to say that.
You know, when I told her, I was talking to her this weekend, and when I told her you're coming on the show, her and a few other family members were like, okay, we have some questions. I'm like, no, I'm not asking any of your questions.
Where are they? How come you didn't invite her?
They're all over the place. They're like all over Ontario here in Canada and stuff. So, you know, they would just take over the show completely. So it's like, it's best this way, you know?
It could be a good thing though.
They'll start cooking and start talking to you about food and drinks and stuff. So maybe you would like it. I don't know.
It'd be fun.
So John, look at, that intro, you do a lot of different stuff. Are you a career nomad by choice, or are you just one of the guys? Are you a little bit like, hey, life is long, I'm going to live it, I'm going to do everything I possibly can and enjoy it along the way?
It's like jack of all trades, master of none kind of thing. I mean, it's just the way life worked out. I mean, you know, I've been playing music my whole life. I ended up going to law school. Probably just should have stuck with the music thing, but it ended up coming in handy. Fell into the film business as an attorney for a while, met my wife, and then ended up working with her as an attorney and as her business partner. And music was always there and always prominent in my life. And now I'm, you know, this is my second band that I've made recordings with, and we're on our second album, and we've been touring incessantly, you know, and just, you know, this is our 10,000th show or something live. And then I ended up getting, you know, just because who knows why, I ended up on Rachel's show, she got thirsty. So I was the guy making the cocktails. So I made a million cocktails on her show. And ended up being fun. And then through necessity during the pandemic, we ended up making shows from home, wherein I was the camera guy and the lighting guy and the sound guy and everything, because there was no one else around and no one else allowed in our house back during the pandemic. And then we started doing shows from home. So
what were you doing? Were you setting up the camera and then running around to the next spot?
We did all of that. I would you know, film her cooking segments. Then when I did a cocktail segment, I would put a tripod up, run in front of the camera. So I probably should have gone to film school instead of law school, but, you know, be that as it may.
So did you, at the end of those, John, did you have the credits? The cameraman, John Cusimano, lighting, John Cusimano?
I never checked the credits, but they better have given me credits, man. That was a lot of work. Getting up, I mean, when we do shows from home, we're up at 4 a.m., She has to prep, you know, we do two meals a day. She has to prep those two meals. There's no one else around. I have to set up all the lighting, the camera, the sound, mic everyone. Well, it's Rachel and me. And then we would, you know, we do, we're doing interviews with guests. That's a whole other camera rig that I have to set up and change the lighting around. And then the control room in New York takes over and controls looks like R2-D2. It's a camera that kind of moves itself. So, a lot of work, but you know, it's rewarding and it's fun. You know, Rachel and I both, we work hard. And
that's awesome.
That's what we do.
That's awesome. It's great that you had that time together and do that production. Now you mentioned lawyering and is it film law or what kind of law was it?
It started out years ago. I was in the film business. Okay. I was buying and selling independent films. Working as a distributor, I would go to the Toronto Film Festival all the time. Would go to Cannes Film Festival, Sundance, and it was fun. I loved it. You know, it was a great job. Then I met Rachael, and she had just started out. I think she had shot a pilot or something on Food Network. And then we started dating, and then about a year or so later, she wanted to start a line of cookware. And she looked at me as the attorney and said, "Can you do that for me?" And at that point, I was very familiar with licensing deals, having sold and bought lots of films. So I said, "Yeah, I think it's pretty much the same contract as selling a film, licensing a film. Instead, I'm licensing a pot or a pan or whatever."
Yeah.
So, a few weeks later, there was this huge, they have it every year in Chicago. It's called the Home and Houseware Show. They have it at McCormick Center in Chicago. And I went there with a stack of homemade Rachael Ray press kits and ended up selling her cookware to the biggest cookware manufacturer in the country called Meyer. They're based out of Vallejo, California. Yep. And the next year we went back, took Rachael back to that same cookware show, houseware show, and launched her her cookware, and just blossomed and grew from there.
So you're the guy behind some of the things I have in my kitchen.
You have in your kitchen, yes.
So one Christmas, you guys, she made the garbage bowl. You know the garbage bowl? She loved the garbage bowl. So not only do we have a garbage bowl, we gave, like, you know, everybody got a garbage bowl for Christmas, right? And they reacted, "Oh my God, the garbage bowl." So you're the guy that licensed helped get the garbage bowl licensed.
That was me.
Right on. Thanks, John. Hey, listen, you also said, intertwined with everything that you started talking to us about, music. And you said, "Well, I probably should have started to do music." Is music your true love? Like, aside from Rachael, is music your true love? And when did it start? Like, when did you go, "Hey, I like music"? Was it one of these situations you start playing violin when you were like 4 years old or something? Or
it was, I mean, when I was a little tiny kid, my parents used to play records for me. They would play Sgt. Pepper. And when the album ended, I would go, "More, more, more," just as a little toddler. So that, you know, that was really the Beatles when I was couldn't even speak. All I could say was "more." That was my first word. That was my first me falling in love with music. And then, you know, it just blossomed from there. I started taking piano lessons at 6 years old. And I took classical, I took jazz. And I also, my dad taught me three chords on the guitar. And he said, he was a big Bob Dylan fan. He said, "Look, Bob Dylan wrote a million songs with three chords. So if you learn three chords, you can play, you know, a whole bunch of songs." So I learned those three chords. And then I like taught myself a whole lot more chords from there. But yeah, that was the beginning of it. When I was six, really, I started playing music.
And dad saying, "Here, play. Here's a guitar, just play."
Yeah, for sure.
G, C, and D.
Those were the chords. They're easy to play for a little kid. You know, there's C's a little hard, but D's easy, and G, you can play it real easily.
I'm still working on those. So just,
you know. All right. Well, you got to crawl before you can walk, right?
I've been crawling for a long time, John. No, I'm kidding. So, okay. So we got the music down and you started at an early age, but then, and you started to talk a little bit about the things that you're doing with Rachael. You've co-authored some books too, I think, and I hope I get these right. My Year in Cocktails and This Must Be the Place, Dispatches and Food from the Home Front. Yeah. And you have a focus both on the cocktail work that you've been doing, on your mixing, on your mixology, right?
Yeah. So I mean, those are Rachael's books. I can't take credit for that, but I did give a lot of cocktail recipes that were incorporated in the book. So My Year in Meals, That book came out a few years ago, and the front cover is Rachael, and it says My Year in Meals. And then if you flip the book over, on the back cover is me, and it says My Year in Cocktails. So I have like my own like book within a book, mini book at the back of her book. And it has like 100 and something cocktail recipes in it. So it really was my year in cocktails. More recently, she had a book called This Must Be the Place. And she wanted to do more than just a recipe book. She wanted to have like essays and stories about her life and what had happened during the pandemic. Specifically, you know, we had lockdown and we were doing the show from our house right here where I'm sitting right now. Then we had our dog Izabu passed. That was in May of 2020, which is, you know, really sad for us.
Yeah.
She passed very gracefully and it was a beautiful day. And we were in the backyard and it was very nice. And then we got our new dog who's asleep just that way in my bed with Rachael right now, Bella. But we had a fire, our house burnt down in the middle of 2020, in the middle of the pandemic. So we had to like run, we had the clothes on our back. We didn't have time to think about what we were gonna take, what we weren't gonna take. We taped ourselves and our dog, of course. And we ran across the street here. We have a little guest house and this house that I'm in now burnt to the ground. So we had nothing left and we were working out of our guest house across the street for about a year or year and a half or so. And it took a year and a half for them to rebuild this house and they did a great job rebuilding it and everything's fine now. But we lost a lot of stuff. Rachael lost all these, you know, there's things that you lose that are replaceable, but then there's things that aren't replaceable. Like Rachael had all these handwritten letters from her mother and all these recipe books, like stacks and stacks of like spiral notebooks that she had handwritten all of her recipes. And those were all gone. And I had about 15 years worth of music charts that I had handwritten. Those, you know, were all gone. But no humans or animals were hurt or died during the fires. That was
the handwritten mom notes kind of hurt more than anything when I hear that.
You can't replace that kind of stuff.
Well, I'm sorry about the fire, man. So it's funny because you bring this up, and I was going to ask you a little bit later because I had made a call. One of the questions I wanted to ask you, I was going to say something like, "Hey, your music's burning down the charts," and my wife, when she knows that I'm doing the interviews, once in a while, she'd be like, "What are you asking?" Well, I got this, this, and this. And when this one came up, she's like, "You can't say that to John." And
oh, that's all good, man. We did that. Rachael is on the board of the Dennis Leary Firefighters Foundation. So she's really dialed into what firefighters do. And we've both done the training. They have this big facility in New York City. It's the biggest firefighter training facility in the country.
Wow.
It's called, it's on Randall's Island. And we've all done that. We put on 50 pounds of bunker gear. We run through controlled, but actual real fire burning buildings and do rope rappelling and all the stuff that the firefighters do. So we have a real respect of what firefighters do. And one of the shows we did, we would do this thing during the pandemic where my band couldn't get together and play. But what we could do is record all of our parts separately and, you know, have little windows like we're doing right now, and glue it all together and do these quarantunes, as we call them at the time. And we would be featured on Rachael's show quite often and we would do different songs and Rachael would actually join us and sing some of the songs. So I think it was Dennis Leary was maybe on the show that week. Or that day, and I think it was around when our house burnt down, and we did a cover of Burning Down the House by Talking Heads. So we have a sense of humor about that stuff. It's all good. Tell your wife it's fine.
Yeah, she was like, you can't, like, their house burned down. I said, I don't know that. I said, she's like, look it, I'm telling you. So then I was like, so anyway, she tries to give me good advice, I guess, you know, John, who knows, right? Look, your cocktail stuff, because we were talking about that. did you get into that because you were around so much the cooking show, or was that always like, hey man, I like mixing stuff. It's in my heritage. It's in my blood. You know, all that sort of stuff. Or
it's kind of both. Like I was into mixing cocktails for quite a long time. I have like pictures of me as a young man, as a teenager, as a, you know, early 20s with a cocktail book, learning how to mix cocktails. And I grew up working in restaurants. And so I've been a bartender, you know, going way back. But then when the show came around, it just was natural for me to do it. I had a proclivity to doing cocktails and to mixing. I had a little bit of, I guess, a flair for doing it.
Yeah.
And, you know, Rachel was so busy making food, and you got to keep the chef happy, right? So I started making cocktails, and then it just became something we did on the show, you know, quite regularly.
It's a great compliment. It's so cool. And I love the way it's, you know, you've combined those things. Listen, before we went, before we turned the, you know, on the air sort of switch on here, you and I were talking about Italy and things like that. Did your grandfather or anybody in your family, did you ever cut up the peaches and put it in the wine growing up?
We didn't do that growing up, but I've definitely heard of that. That sounds like something Rachel's grandfather would do. You know, he was up here in the Lake George area back when she was a little girl. And, you know, he would hunt for all the food, serve rabbit that he would hunt.
Yeah.
You know, and he would thing he would do for dessert is he would have these hand melons, and he would cut them with him a machete that he had. And then he would fill the melons with ice cream and give them to the kids, and the kids would love that.
Yeah, it's funny. It's interesting. So my grandfather, who on my mom's side, he came from Calabria, and they would do like that, some of those traditions, right? So as a kid, I remember sitting on his lap, cutting the fruit up. He'd put it in, and he'd feed me. So I'd get these really nicely soaked peaches full of wine.
Right? You're a happy baby.
I was. So look at, there's a guy I know up here in Toronto. He owns a place. It's called Chaser's Fresh Juice. He distributes these fresh juices across Canada. He works sort of internationally and stuff. Best fresh juice I've ever had. He likes to mix juices, and you know, every time I go see him, oh, try this or try that. With summer coming around the corner, if I wanted to hit him up and say, hey, give me some fresh juices, could you give us an idea? And he tells me that one of the popular mixes that comes up that restaurants are, but it doesn't have to be this, is watermelon mint. But I basically have any kind of fresh juice available to me. What could I make that's a nice cocktail before supper, John? You have any ideas you could throw our way?
Yeah, I mean, if you have a watermelon mint juice, that just lends, especially during summer, that lends itself to a great, you could do like a watermelon mint martini. It's pretty simple. I mean, basically, you're doing that juice and vodka, but you can kind of zhuzh it up a little bit. What I would do maybe is you get your cocktail shaker, take some fresh mint just to amp up the mint part of it, put like three or four leaves and hit it with a muddler just a few, like eight times maybe, just to break open the capsules on the mint,
yeah,
and really flavor the cocktail. Then put in some vodka. You do like for one cocktail, I put in an ounce and a half of vodka, maybe an ounce and a half of this watermelon mint juice. And then I would add a little bit, maybe 3/4 of an ounce of orange liqueur, like triple sec or Cointreau or Curacao, something like that. And then maybe if you need a little extra sweetness, put in a half an ounce at the most of simple syrup, which is basically half sugar, half water. You melt the sugar in the water and you can store that in the fridge. Then shake it up with ice, strain it into a chilled martini glass, and then nice, garnish it with a mint leaf. And then that's going to be a really refreshing, really fun, delicious summer drink. I would do that for sure.
I'm going to try it and send you a picture of it.
call it the guidotini.
The guidotini?
Yeah.
Thank you, man. Thank you. No, seriously, I wanted to try that because the guy, like I said, he's got all the juices. So I thought, hey, who better to ask? So, John, we've been talking about a lot of things. Rachel's come up quite a bit. One site that I was on calls, you know, says John Cusimano, best known for, says being married to Rachael Ray. And then they list all these other things that you do that we're talking about here today, including that we're going to get some more of your music, because that's why we're here, is talk music, actually. Is it hard? And maybe this will lead in. Is it hard to get recognized for your music when you're married to such a beloved TV personality who gives, let's be honest, she gives people hope, she gives them comfort, she does it through food and the kitchen and where we spend the, you know, the bulk of our lives with family and friends around something. You know, is it hard to get to your music, to get past all of that sometimes in your experiences, I guess?
Well, it, you know, it's a great way to get the music out there for sure. And she's always been supportive of my music and featuring it on the show. But that was, you know, one of the reasons why we started this band during the pandemic, Fastest Land Animal, was to have a project where it wasn't my last band. And the idea was, this is why we came up with these fake names, like, you know, my fake name, Screaming Jack Novak, so that people would hear this music, we'd put it out there, and we wouldn't, we couldn't tour, so people couldn't see us, because there was no games or anything. And we didn't put our faces on the album or in any of the videos early on. So I wanted to kind of get a sense of what people thought of the music, just as the music, and not knowing who we were, and kind of guessing at, oh, who are these guys? Do we know them? Do we not know them? So that really was the reason behind Fastest Land Animal. And it was this great experiment. And I probably would have kept it going until now. But obviously we went on tour and started playing gigs. So yeah, we can't kind of, it's hard to hide when you're playing live in front of people. And then back when the first album, after it came out, a few weeks into it, we had the opportunity to be on a radio show called it's the Howard Stern Wrap Up Show.
Yeah.
We're, you know, kind of buddies with Gary Delabate, who's Howard's executive producer. And he had me on the show and Rachael too. And then we were, you know, I was promoting the band and plugging the band. So at that point, the cat was out of the bag. But there was like a month or two early on when the first album came out that no one knew who we were. And it was really fun to hear reactions to the album, and people didn't know who we were, and we were being compared to bands like Queens of the Stone Age and Eagles of Death Metal. And, you know, this is all very, you know, I'm thrilled to be compared to bands like that. I, you know, those are both great bands. So yeah, it was really fun to just have something with no preconceived notions attached to it. And that was the idea of this band.
So do you go now when you're playing live, are you playing your alter egos or are you playing yourselves?
We're playing the alter egos, but you know, people kind of, I think they recognize me.
Does screaming Jack Novak dress differently than John Cusimano?
I don't know. Screaming Jack Novak's punk rocker. He kind of just dresses like this. He wears a leather biker jacket probably. Not that much different than what I would normally wear, but.
So as we're talking Fastest Land Animal, I typed the name. I got to tell you the story. I typed the name into the search engine and a picture of a cheetah comes up.
That's the fastest.
So then cheetah. That's the fastest land animal, right? So then I thought, you know, the new thing is this ChatGPT, artificial intelligence, right? So I go over to the ChatGPT AI engine and I say, is the fastest land animal John Cusimano? And the AI robot replies to me and says, no, John Cusimano is not the fastest land animal. John Cusimano is a human being, not an animal. The fastest land animal, as I mentioned earlier, is the cheetah. So the AI engine says, you're not an animal, John.
Well, I mean, I'm a human. Like, humans are animals, technically, but yeah, I guess that's sort of accurate. I'm definitely
What's the meaning behind fastest land animal? What gave this life?
Well, it was a name I had. My last band was called The Cringe, and that was a name I had sort of been carrying around with me for a while, and I never really liked that name, but, you know, kind of started out as a joke years ago, and then I stuck with it. But I thought of this name, Fastest Land Animal, years back, and I never used it because I had The Cringe, And I always thought, this is a really cool name. Someone's going to think of it. Someone's going to use it. And then back in 2020, when I decided, hey, I'm going to do a new project, I think I'm going to call it Fastest Land Animal. And I Googled it and I came up with a cheetah like you. Like, no one had come up with this idea of naming a band Fastest Land Animal. So I'm like, cool, I'm going to use that name. And then that kind of led, the idea was to have this band, every song needed to be fast, like Fastest Land Animal, like a cheetah.
Right.
So the rule was with the first album and most of the second album as well that just came out, East Coast, West Coast, in between, no songs slower than 150 beats per minute. So we're talking pretty fast songs and short songs, punk rock, you know, yeah, melodic punk rock. And then on the new album, kind of crossed over a little bit to new wave. So that was the basic mindset to start this band. And once I had those rules in place, then I was able to write songs that fit into that model, if you can. And that's how the band started. And that's why we're called Fastest Land Animal.
That's cool. So the name's actually tied to the type of music or the speed and the style of the music that you actually want to play. So that's kind of cool that's happening. Now, John, if you were an animal, what's your favorite animal? What would you be? Would you be the cheetah?
Maybe a dolphin.
A dolphin.
I love the ocean. I love swimming. And dolphins, they seem really smart and they have family units. And they're just cute. Ever since I was a little kid, I've always loved dolphins. So maybe I want to be a dolphin.
All right. I wonder if they're the fastest in the sea? I'm going to have to look it up now. I'll have to ask the AI.
I'm sure about that. I know barracudas are pretty fast.
Yeah, maybe they're not.
I don't know about dolphins.
But they're cute and friendly, John. So we'll go with that. You mentioned the cringe. You have a different lineup in Fastest Land Animal than you did in the cringe.
Yeah, there's some crossover. But you know, it's slightly different band members.
Why? So I get you gave us the philosophy behind the name, but were you at all concerned? Like, the cringe did have some brand recognition already, right?
Yeah. I mean, but the whole point was to leave all that behind and do something completely new that people weren't familiar with. And, I'm glad we did it. It's really fun. It's liberating in a way, especially because in the cringe, I played rhythm guitar and sang at the same time. And in this band, I'm not playing any guitar at all. I write the songs on guitar, but then once I write the songs, I put the guitar down. I'm just the lead singer. That's it. So it's kind of liberating. It frees me up to be able to interact with the crowd a little more, be more of a showman, not be glued to that mic stand and not have to, you know, deal with tuning a guitar and, the amp and the mix in my ear is just a lot easier to deal with. And I'm really enjoying the freedom that gives me. So I forget what the question was, but
the transition. No, it was a transition from the cringe to the Fastest Land Animal. But, you know, as you're kind of talking about that and the freedom, and I'm thinking you're a trio, right? In Fastest Land Animal, the trio works.
It does. On the record, we're a trio. When we tour live, you know, Johnny Blaze, who is, his name is Alphonse Castillo on the record. Yeah. He plays all the guitars and basses and bass on the record. He can't do all of that at the same time when we play live. We need extra help. So when we tour, we do tour with, he plays bass and we have two extra guitar players, Danny Rosselli, who plays guitars and keyboards and sings backing vocals. He's like our utility guy. And Tommy Hayes plays guitar as well. So there's five of us when we tour. Okay. And that, because we got two guitars going and the bass and the drums, I there's no need for me to play guitar.
You're not getting into overdubbing or anything like that. I guess when you're playing live, right? It's a nice live sound with everybody. Now you did some recording during the pandemic. It sounds like you did some songs and you talked a little bit about some of the challenges or whatever. What was it? You just recorded your track, sent them all in, did the Zoom thing. And how did that all work out?
What happened was, like, back at the early stages of Fastest Land Animal, I had a bunch of songs that I, you know, I just write demos right here in this room that we're hanging out in on guitar, record them. And then over the course of time, I have, you know, enough songs that, okay, great. I got an album here. So I had all these fast songs that were punky and like they needed work, but they were, you know, the bones were there for an album. So I was, you know, I was stuck at home during the pandemic. This was like March 2020.
Yeah.
Spring of 2020, couldn't go anywhere. My band were, we were all over the country. My Johnny, our bass player guitarist, is in Arizona, still is, and our drummer is in Houston, Texas, and our producer Don Gilmore is in LA or Seattle, depending upon where he was working. So we were separated, but we all had the benefit of having home studios in our homes, so we knew we could record parts separately and glue it together in the end. So that's what we did for that first record. And actually was a really efficient way of working. We were able to not, I mean, nothing beats getting together and going to a studio and recording together as a band, but we're so familiar with, we've been playing together for so long that we knew, it was almost like we were together because we just knew what we were gonna do, even though we weren't doing it together. So we did the first album remotely. And it ended up like sounding great and being an easy way to work. So we ended up doing the second album that way also, even though at that point the pandemic had ended and we could have gotten together, but we're home anyway. You could, you know, work all day and then I could walk downstairs and have dinner with my wife and not have to worry about travel or any of that stuff. So that's what we did for the second album as well.
That's phenomenal. Like I would, if I didn't know that, I wouldn't know that it was recorded, like, you know, in all these different places and so well put together. Like it's so tight for remote, building it remotely like that, John.
Yeah. We just work for so long and we work so well together that we kind of, you know, musically finish each other's sentences. So it's easy for us to work like that and make it sound like we're together because, you know, mentally we're together, even though physically we're far apart.
So John, what's the path or the journey from the first album to when you, or from the album to, for you to get to East Coast, West Coast and in between? What's the idea there naming that album, that name?
Well, the name came from just because I'm here in New York, I'm the East Coast. Johnny's on the West Coast in Arizona and Don, you know, he's on the West Coast. And then in between is where, Andrew Meskin, we also call him Shark Samuels. He's in Houston, Texas, which is in between. So it's pretty literal
geography.
You know. Yeah, it's geography. But I guess the evolution from sort of we evolved a little bit from the first to the second album. The first album is really our New York album. It's sounds, even though it wasn't recorded in New York City, I just brought all that New York City energy to me. It was a New York City punk rock record. And then this second album is a little more, has that like Western cowboy kind of thing happening. It still has that East Coast punk rock thing going on, but, musically it expanded a little more. There's a little more synth work in it. So it kind of, it goes a little bit more into the new wave, the early 80s new wave, late 70s, early 80s new wave thing musically. And then lyrically, there's just a lot of cowboy, dusty, middle of the country, you know, West Texas, high desert imagery in there lyrically. It was a little bit more of what was going on.
So I struggle with this because I always say, you know, when we talk with artists and we say, oh, you know, you sound like, hey, John, you sound like da 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 da, right? But so I'm listening to your body of work, right, between the albums, and I'm hearing all sorts of things. I'm hearing some Rush, some Pink Floyd, some Ramones, some Pistols, some Misfits, some Johnny Thunders. So much for whatever reason, Johnny Thunder stuck in my head. I had to go and look up some Johnny Thunder stuff after I was listening to it, but. And you know, and you got these melodies. I'm a big Guns N' Roses guy, right? And there's some melodies. They stretch out their melodies sometimes. And some of your songs have these beautifully stretched out melodies that, but they work in that fast pace too, right? And you're going, Guido, you're all over the place. Right? What are you painting me here?
And those are also my favorite bands you've mentioned. I mean, Guns N' Roses, Appetite for Destruction is like a perfect rock record, if ever there was one.
Yeah, it is a good album.
You know, you're in Toronto, so you have to mention Rush, of course. And, you know, Pink Floyd, I grew up listening. It's just in my DNA. And, you know, of course, the Ramones and the Misfits and the Pistols and Johnny Thunder. I mean, these are all seminal artists that influenced certainly me just listening to them, but also specifically Fastest Land Animal, because, you know, we are, you know, rooted in punk rock, and those are seminal artists in the history of punk rock. So, I mean, I'm in good company.
So I'm not crazy. Like, when I hear that stuff, I'm not crazy hearing that stuff. Like, okay.
Not at all. I mean, we all grow up listening to a wide array of music, and it just bleeds into what you do, whether you wanted to or not, or whether you're, you know, I wasn't trying to make a Dark Side of the Moon prog rock record, but
right.
Those influences are just there. I can't help it. And they seep through, I guess. Which is a good thing.
Now, John, and I say that, but at the same time, you have an FLA sound, like you've got your Fastest Land Animal sound. And at the same time, I'm going, John's got, they've got enough of a sound that at some point I'm probably going to compare some other band and say, hey, they sound like Fastest Land Animal. Right.
I mean, that's the best compliment. Thank you.
So I guess, you know, it is the influences that you have, and it kind of seeped into your lyrics and your music and whatnot. I mentioned earlier, you know, my wife says, hey, you know, these questions about, you know, asking John or not asking John certain things. And she says to me, do you know that he plays 9 instruments? And I said, no, I didn't. So then I thought, I think it means I'm supposed to ask you if you play 9 instruments, because she didn't say to me, ask him, but it was that tone where it was like, did you know that he played 9 instruments? Do you
really play 9 instruments? My wife likes to say I play 700 instruments, whatever it is. But okay, so I play keyboards. So if you ask Rachael, I play piano, that's one instrument, organ, that's another instrument, synthesizer, I have 7 different types of synthesizers. So now we're up to like 9 instruments, and then, you know, electric piano. And okay, so it's all keyboard. So I play keyboards, and I'm a pretty decent keyboard player. I play guitar, so that's 2, but you know, it's not, you know, I play guitar, I play acoustic guitar, I play electric guitar, I play 12 string guitar. It's all guitar. Right. So okay. This is where things get a little like not so accurate. I do play banjo. I've gotten, like, you know, it's
that's pretty awesome
to play. I'm playing finger picking scrug style banjo, which is really a blast. In fact, I have a side project with friends of mine in New York City. It's called the Hootenanny, and we get together and we play bluegrass versions of rock and pop songs. And then, you know, I play, I can play drums too and bass. So I got like rock band stuff covered.
You play a lot of different instruments. Now, I know you said, hey, I really enjoy singing with the band. Out of all of that stuff, if you had to play an instrument, what's your go-to? What's your favorite?
I mean, the one I'm best at is piano and keyboards.
Piano.
I love piano. I love playing classical music. I love playing jazz. I love playing rock. The one I write on the most is probably guitar. It just lends itself to writing the type of music I'm writing.
Yeah. Do you name your instruments or your guitar or anything? Or?
No, not necessarily. I do. Like, I have, I can show you that. I had this one. This is a gift from my wife. This is the, basically it's the Kurt Cobain guitar. It's,
that's beautiful.
Yeah, it's a 1960s Fender Mustang. And, you know, I have a pretty decent bunch of guitars that I like playing. And, you know, you really get inspired when you play a certain guitar. Just the sound of it and just holding it makes you, like, feel like you're harnessing something, you know, that you that's beyond imagination. And it's really fun to have guitars that you love, that you adore, that you just like playing.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I've talked to a few people when we talk about guitars and just the relationship that you have with that instrument, right? And when you take it with you I was talking on one show and we were saying, you know, and I'm looking over here because my guitar is sitting over there. And, you know, it's got the little nicks and scratches and, sure. And you, sometimes you remember where that happened or what it's from or
the character. You know,
character, right? But it is, when you talk to somebody who plays guitar, it's always, they have this relationship with the instrument. Like it's something, it's part of them and you care about it. That's why I said, do you have a name for it? Cause sometimes people name their guitars or whatever. How about music videos and streams? Fastest Land Animal is racking up a lot of views in terms of some of your video content. Are you and Andrew and Johnny, are you where you thought you wanted to be in terms of that response with Fastest Land Animal?
Yeah, I mean, I'm so out of my element when it comes to this stuff, but Andrew's really good at that. And during the pandemic, when that first album came out, we were making, and first of all, we couldn't get together and do videos. Second of all, we wanted to be incognito, so we didn't want to show ourselves. So he came up with this bright idea, and you should check out the video if you haven't already. It's the first single off our first record called Too Close to the Fire, and it's sock puppets. The video is all just sock puppets being us and playing in a sock puppet rock band. So that's kind of where we started things. And then we did a video with TVs on our heads so you couldn't see our faces. And so it is a lot of fun to try and come up with something, you know, not so serious, kind of clever, but, you know, has a rock and roll spirit to it.
If I'm a new listener to Fastest Land Animal, what's in the catalog of songs, which song do you tell me to listen to?
Well, I guess you could do worse than start with the sock puppet video, Too Close to the Fire.
Yeah.
On our new album, the first single off that album is Out of Range. That's a good place to start too. And then that Police cover next to you is a pretty fun thing to listen to.
I'm just writing these down because I want to add them to the notes after for suggestions and stuff.
Cool, thanks.
What's next? Like, what do you got going on for Fastest Land Animal in terms of shows or some touring, more music videos? Yeah. What do we have to look forward to?
Well, tomorrow, actually day after tomorrow, we're going to Omaha. We got a gig there with our good friends in the band Tesla. We've been touring with them incessantly for many years now. We love those guys. Still working on the new album, and then we, you know, the summer's here already, so we'll be cobbling together a tour. We're in the process of it. A lot of gigs coming up this summer and the beginning of 2024. So we'll be hopefully coming to a gig near you soon.
You gonna cross the border? You gonna come see us?
Yeah, man. We love, you know, we played as the Cringe. We toured all over Canada and all over North America with Motley Crue and Alice Cooper. Uh-huh. So we've played Quebec City, Toronto, Montreal, Edmonton, Calgary, and Vancouver. All great cities. So we've seen quite a bit of that big country north of the 49th parallel.
I'm hoping you're coming back, and so are others, John.
I hope so. Have some poutine, man.
Well, yeah, I guess. Or come for some pasta puttanesca. How about that?
Hey, it sounds good.
Where can folks best connect with you and the other band members online? You know, like, what's your favorite social media channel if you have one? Where is the best place to become a Fastest Land Animal fan and get merch and listen to the music and all that stuff?
I would say go to fastestlandanimal.band. And from there, that's the hub, and it'll take you everywhere you need to go. Fastestlandanimal.band.
Okay. And all your links are off of that hub for folks then?
Everything.
Right on. John, I've bombarded you with questions. And I know you got busy stuff going on there. Is there anything you'd like to leave us with before I let you go?
I just want to say thank you for this time, Guido. It was a pleasure hanging out with you. And we will see you out on the road as soon as possible.
That is John Cusimano, lawyer, mixologist, active producer, author, and with his band Fastest Land Animal, a lyricist, vocalist, and guitarist, alongside bad mates Andrew Meskin on drums, Johnny Blaze on guitar and bass. I'll have his social media contact information in the show notes. And stay tuned, because we're going to hear some Fastest Land Animals music right here on the show. Thank you, John. Take care, and hope that you'll be back in the future.
Peace out, my brother.
What a great segment with John Cusimano there. Lots of great stories. Fastest Land Animal. Check them out. I'll have all the information, along with all the other information from our other guests here on the show, in the podcast notes. Look, we've come to the end of our show here in June, and thank you again for being here with me and for tuning in and for giving myself and our guests some listening time. We hope you enjoyed the show. If you haven't yet, please consider subscribing. It would be much appreciated. Check out our other shows on YouTube, The Path Radio, The Coach's Call, all in the podcast notes. Thank you again. Let's have John and Fastest Land Animal take us out with their song Answer in My Head.
And all my